Oh, Jesus, you're my all in all. Jesus, you're my everything. Oh, Jesus, you're my all in all. Jesus, you're my everything. Jesus, you're my all in all. Jesus, you're my everything. In Christ alone I am found. In Christ alone is solid ground. In Christ alone I am free. In Christ alone for eternity. In Christ alone I am found. In Christ alone solid ground. In Christ alone I am free. In Christ alone. But you were wounded for my transgressions, bruised for my sin, punished for my peace so I could live. But you were wounded for my transgressions, bruised for my sin, punished for my peace so I could live. You pay, no greater price you pay than the love you freely gave for me. Oh, no greater price you pay, no greater price you pay than the love you freely gave for me. Oh, no greater price you pay. Transgression, bruised for my sin, punished for my peace so I could live. But you were wounded for my transgression, bruised for my sin, punished for my peace so I could live. Yes, you were wounded for my transgression, bruised for my sin, punished for my peace so I could live. And no greater price you pay, no greater price you pay than the love you freely gave for me. No greater price you pay, no greater price you pay than the love you freely gave for me. So I could live in you. So I could live in you. So I could be made alive by you. Raised up together with you. Raised to newness of life. Raised up together with you. alone. I am free in Christ alone. For eternity in Christ alone. Christ alone, my all and all.
Hallelujah.
Christ alone, my everything. Jesus, you're my all and all. Jesus, you're my everything. Jesus, you're my all and all. Jesus, you're my everything. Jesus, you're my all and all. Jesus, you're my all and all. Jesus, you're my everything.
Open wide the gates of your heart and the King's glory shall come in. Open wide the gates of your heart with the praise made is acceptable to him. Open wide the gates of your heart and see the glory of the Father. Open wide the gates of your heart and watch a worship flow forth to him. All our praises in you, O God. All our delights in your sanctuary. Let the glory of the Father overshadow you. Let the beauty of his presence rapture you away. Let the glory of the Father overshadow you. Let the beauty of his presence rapture you away. And the issues from your belly shall be the songs of the Spirit. And the brightness on your face shall be his countenance. Uh-huh. this your opportunity to tell the Father what you think about Him. This is your opportunity to sing praise unto the Son, right from the belly, right from the very realms of the Spirit. This is your opportunity to declare to God who He is and let Him reveal to you who He is. This is your opportunity to praise and to worship. Out of that will come forth prophecy, miracles, signs and wonders by Jesus Christ.
Something beautiful. Something beautiful. Let it be a joyful sound. Something beautiful. Let it be a joyful sound. Something beautiful. There are high praises and a sound like heaven and something beautiful. Let it be joyful. Hallelujah. For with joy shall you draw water. With joy you draw water. With joy and rejoicing you draw water. Or something beautiful. Let the praise be something beautiful. Something beautiful. Let the offering that you bring to Father be a gift so wrapped, so fine. Something beautiful. Bring something beautiful. Bring that praise worthy of His name and be acceptable. Something joyful. Something beautiful. Song and a dance and a praise that belongs only to the people of the Lord. With a song and a dance and a praise that belongs to something called supernatural. Oh, with a song and a dance and a praise that belongs to the realms of heaven. Something beautiful. Something sounding joyous, these high praises, singing, making melody, something beautiful, with hymns and songs and spiritual songs, something joyful, bring the praise, bring the praise, let me hear the praise. Bring the praise, come thanksgiving, the prayer of faith. Something beautiful, something worthy of your name, something worthy of your house. Something worthy of His house and worthy of His name. Bring it now. Hallelujah. Something joyful. Something glorious. Something beautiful. Something worthy of His name. Bring it now. joy that goes beyond that which is earthly. Supernatural. Oh, it's a praise that sounds so fine. Supernatural. Thanksgiving from heaven. Make it beautiful.
Father, you've done everything so perfectly. Oh God, you've done everything just for me. Oh God, you made all things well, and you established it eternally. And oh God, your love that goes beyond description, your person higher still,
you're so wonderful. Love me with a love that's everlasting. Oh God, the things you do so amazing. Oh God, so beautiful, so spectacular, better than the rainbow in the brightness of its colors. Oh God, the things you do so glorious, more spectacular than the universe lit up with all your stars and planets and things. Oh God, something beautiful, something worthy of your name. Bring something beautiful, something beautiful to the King. Bring some praise that's worthy of his name. A supernatural dance, oh, in the offering of all things, something joyful. Spectacular, amazing, something supernatural that only the Holy Ghost can do. Something supernatural, like rivers of God flowing out through you. Something spectacular and wonderful, looks like the presence of the Lord when you sing. Bring something beautiful. Hallelujah. Go ahead and give it a try. That only God can make. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Saved by your amazing grace, your love took my place. Given your best, your holiness, your spirit, oh Lord. So that I might learn to worship, so that I might learn to honor you and give thanks unto your name. All something beautiful.
So, so glorious, so supernatural. Goes beyond all that men could think or ask. Goes beyond all that men could do. Something beautiful. Hallelujah. Father, we thank you for all of your signs and your wonders and your miracles and the supernatural expressions, O Lord, of the Holy Ghost. And Father, you have taken my tongue and you have made it as the pen of a ready writer to speak, O God, your words. To declare, O God, the things, Lord, that you are writing right now and making known and want to make known, that goes so beyond all the human realm and human knowledge and human perception, that would then begin to bring revelation and reveal the thoughts and the intent of the heart and make known the secrets of the heart. Oh God, that would be so real and so full of truth that it touches the deepest, darkest places in the earth and in the hearts of men. Something supernatural. Something beautiful and glorious. Now, Father, we know that only clean and pure vessels can bring forth this kind of things. Those washed in the blood whose hearts are set on remaining that way. And so, Father, tonight we pray that there would not be one person in this place who is unwilling to be taught of you and receive all that you have supplied so that we could be that, live in that realm so beautiful. So supernatural. Father, and those that are in this place that might be deceived to think that there's something for them in the realms of the lust of the flesh and the lust of the eye and the pride of life, that there's something for them in the realm of the demonic and the sensual. Father, we pray tonight that in your mercy they will have a great breakthrough of revelation so that they can see things as they really are and recognize that only in you can there be found something beautiful, something glorious and supernatural. Only you supply those things, O God, that are worth living. And you give life to the spirit and soul as the spirit and soul gives life to the body. And without you, Lord, we're dead while we live and empty on the inside. And we pray tonight that there will not be one person standing here in this place that leaves without this glorious, wonderful work of divine grace, being the house and the living place, the housing of the Lord, where your glorious rivers that flow forth from your throne room come issuing forth, that all day long we drinking and the people around us are drinking of that, oh God, which you supply out of this realm of praise that is so beautiful. A gift, an offering so beautiful. See, holy is a word superior to beautiful, and holy is a word superior to all that would be described as splendor. It's a word belonging and describing the glory of our everlasting God and King, the eternal God. Almighty is his name. And he's opened up the door, Christ Jesus, so that you and I can begin to enter in and understand something that is far superior to beautiful. And he wants to cause you to have excellency of speech. He wants to teach you by his own instruction and inspiration as he makes your tongue like the pen of a ready writer and describes all that he is. Hallelujah. Let him describe through you right now all that he is. He's so wonderful. Let him describe. He is the mighty God, the everlasting Father. Oh, he's the one who is from age to age the same. Ha, Hallelujah. Thank you, God. Father, we pray tonight that everyone would begin to reckon with and comprehend this wonderful thing that you've done when you made us your temple, your house, the place where you dwell. Oh, yeah. Father, that the people in this place would begin to understand tonight what you did when you caused us to come forth miraculously by the Spirit as your sons and as your daughters, your own, your begotten family. No, you're just not getting it, are you? You can do it now. You can start thinking him now. If you think him now, you might begin, you'll begin to move into the faith. Wait. Honestly, think about it. You can't take these things for granted. You can't act as though it's normal. A friend of mine was with me and rabbits were jumping around. He said, look at all the rabbits. I said, yeah, the rabbits. He said, quit acting like it's normal. Because he's from a place they never see rabbits. Quit acting like being the house of God is something normal. Quit act like being begotten of the Father, being sons and daughters, the family of the Most High, is something casual. No, the problem is that you've got to begin to understand that something stopped up your well that's keeping you from being able to have the revelation that brings forth praise. And tonight, the cure is in your response. Do not be despondent. If I did nothing more than preach a sermon over and over again, you can't be despondent and move forward with God and got you to be a place of responding to Him. It's responding to Him. People want to respond. They want a responsive reading. They want to respond to men. It's time that you respond to Him. Because you can never do a miracle unless He shows you, and it's a response to a supernatural event of God. You can't just do it mentally because you think it should be done. You can't prophesy because it's just something that you think should be done and it's all mental. It's a response to God. You can't do any of the things that belong to the realms of heaven until you learn how to respond. And that all starts over here and being just so exceedingly thankful of what God has done for us through His only begotten Son, the blood that cleansed us from all sin, the Holy Spirit that now lives within, this work of divine power and grace, that whatever we ask, Father, He will do, the reality that He's now standing in this place, the Father who wills and abides and walks and lives and moves in us, that He's our God and we are His people. Woohoo! Yeah, this is your time to shout. This is your time to shout to the Lord. There's a breakout. Shout to the Lord. Dear people, hallelujah. There is a breakout in the shout. There is a release of divine glory in that which God has supplied. Oh yeah, understand that as you begin to lift up your voice and you begin to worship Him and you begin to praise Him and it begins to take a hold of you in such a way
that it captivates all of your strength and all of your energy because you're not willing to have it be normal or casual. It's got to be beautiful. It's got to be supernatural. There's a breakout there. There's a breakout there. And if you'll believe it, I mean, I think that some people, I don't know why some people do. I don't get it. But if you'll just be like a little child, be humble before the Lord, and because he guides the meek in his way. If you're saying, I don't believe it, or I don't agree with it, or I tried it once and nothing happened, you know, you're just going to have to understand that we're telling you the truth. We're not lying to you. We're not making it up. We're disclosing to you what was revealed in His Word and what we discovered in participation with Him. And then when we begin to understand that He is supplying something to us, and so that's why Paul said, I will sing in the Spirit, because there is a supply. So that I can sing with this understanding also. Hallelujah. That there is a place of me being filled. Hallelujah. There's a place of you being filled. There's a place of this assembly for you to be baptized right now in the Holy Ghost and fire. Oh, that's enough inspiration. That's enough celebration. That's enough divine grace and working. You know, and I was just so blessed for people participating here tonight. And I just want you to understand, God wants to take it to higher heights. And the more you do it, the stronger it will become. If you don't have anything else to say in those moments where we're saying it's your time, it's your opportunity, then you begin to cry out to God. Oh, God, baptize me in your fire. Baptize me in your glory. Oh, Lord, let your wellspring flow. Let your rivers flow. Don't be willing to be anything less than bringing an offering that is, look, people, the reality of it is the enemy of our souls, the prince of the power of the air, has made all of this look like something ridiculous and stupid and meaningless. And the only thing that's going to change that is because God's people are going to be willing to labor to take a hold of that which is supernatural and beautiful and joyful. Come on now. It's got to go beyond what man can do. Tonight they're doing the Oscars, and they're going to make it look beautiful, and they're going to make it look spectacular. And they're going to try to honor what men have called the best of the best, who are superior to everything else and everything that's going on. They've got the carpet rolled out, and they've got the diamonds, and they've got the jewels, and they've got the dress, and they've got all the performance, and they've got all the pomp, and they've got all the circumstance. And if that's what you want to do, you'll never compete with that. The Father wants to give something to us that's so beautiful. And every cooperation with sin contaminates it and make it look so ugly. And every cooperation with doubt and unbelief contaminates it and makes it look so reproachful. And every place where you yield yourself to any kind of strife or division, it's a false representation. Yeah. Holy Ghost is here. Amen. No, you can't just stand there and look at me and say that you believe that. Because that when you believe that, it will cause you to tremble. It will cause faith to arise in you. You go, if your eyes were open to be able to see the Holy Ghost is here, you think about it. The servant of Elisha's eyes were open to see that there was angels all around them, and that was enough for him to be able to conquer an entire nation. We don't want you sitting despondent. We don't want you sitting isolated in darkness, blinded by all the stuff that has imposed itself upon you, that you have opened the door and invited in. Tonight, we want you to come in a place of consecration unto Him and begin to recognize, wait a minute, God Almighty stands right now in this place. God Almighty stands right here right now in this place. He does. He stands right here in this place. And He stands right now in our lives. And He so wants to be revealed. He so wants to be made manifest. But Father has set it up to where that it's only through our participation with Him and our cooperation with Him that He's going to be. And none of us of ourselves are capable or able in any way. None of us are sufficient to be able in any way to measure up to that. So He empowers us with a divine grace that we didn't have to participate with. Father has empowered us. Father has empowered us tonight to be holy even as He's holy. To be righteous even as He's righteous. To be pure just like He's pure. To walk in the light just like He's in the light. To function and flow in that which all of a sudden takes all the shame away. The miracles, the signs and the wonders, credible ones. Ones that can't be denied. And Father wants to work more than just one miracle here tonight.
Amen.
Let me say this, the Lord invited every person that came into this meeting tonight to be a part of the body of Christ, to be baptized or immersed down into His body by the Holy Spirit. But you had to come prepared to preach. You had to come prepared to prophesy. You had to come prepared to flow and function in the river of divine grace and the manifestation of the Spirit. And if you didn't, then you're ill prepared. You didn't come to bring something beautiful. Listen, I've had a lot of people give me things for my house. And I promise you, they are not in my house. Huh? They didn't make the cut of what I call beautiful. I'm sure it was given out of a sincere heart, and you know. Now I have some paintings that are pretty spectacular. Those are there. I have a couple of things that people gave me that are costly. They're beautiful. They're there. But the cheap stuff didn't even get to the garage. Tonight, I'm going to bring something beautiful. Something that fits in His house. It fits in the company of the mighty. If your eyes could be open tonight and you could begin to see what's going around the throne. And then recognize that He supplied you with ability to do all of that and more. That you don't have to stand in the shadows saying, my goodness, oh, there's no way that I can even stand shoulder to shoulder with that or even participate in that. But recognize, wait a minute, He's empowered you with something so glorious. That if you'll learn how to function and flow in this realm, it will always be supernatural. Ooh, it will always be beautiful. And I think that maybe folks are standing around and somehow thinking that they've got to have a couple of sentences or paragraph or two that's going to, you know, be unique and that never, no one has ever heard before. No. It's telling God who He is to you. Saying, Lord, You're amazing to me. You're wonderful to me. I can't imagine that I get to be a part of Your family, but I am, and I'm just so thankful. That kind of stuff. But it's everybody doing it from the heart. It's not necessarily even the volume of your voice. It is the passion of your soul. It's the passion that drives it forward. It's passion. It's not necessarily closing your eyes and looking down to the ground. It's opening them and looking up. It's really not in the sound of a squeal or hurt or sorrow. It's get the sorrow dealt with. If you're burning for the lost, do that in your closet. To where that when you get here, this is about Him. It's a joyful sound. If you got to pray the prayer, oh God, don't leave me out. Oh God, don't leave me out. Oh God, don't leave me out. Do that where nobody else can hear you. Go out in the woods somewhere. Garage is another good place. In your car, nobody can hear you. Right? Huh? But when you get here, start telling him, oh God, I thank you that you didn't leave me out. I thank you that I'm in you and you're in me, that you washed me, cleansed me, made me pure.
Thank you, Jesus.
If you can't, if for some reason you don't know how to begin, because I know that there's some people in here, you know, you don't, I can tell after so many events that you don't really understand how to begin. Go ahead and write it out. And when we say, okay, it's time for you just to worship the Lord and just tell him how you feel about him, go ahead and read it. Lord, I think you're amazing. You're wonderful. You're glorious. I'm so happy that you're my dad and I get to be your son, father. Well, a mother may forget their child, but I know you will never forget me. And Lord Jesus, you're amazing. I can't believe you're my best friend and my elder brother. And just read it. And after a while, you'll want that paper up. The Holy Spirit will give you an utterance. God, the Holy Spirit will enrich you with all utterance and every spiritual gift. He will enrich you tonight. If you will agree with him and if you will believe him, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. You know, if I measured this on the scale of what everybody else is doing, I would say great worship, great praise, praise God for it, and I do. But I'm not measured on that scale. I'm measured on the scale of what Father's been wanting to do. Whoopee-doo. So you and I are cut above what everybody else is doing. That is, what does that mean? What does that even mean? You know, or even if we were keeping up with the Joneses, what does that mean? What does that even mean? The issue is, what does Father want, and what does he describe, and what is praise supposed to look like? You know, and what does worship and praise look like, and what does flowing in the Holy Ghost really truly look like? You know, David just assigned the priest to worship the Lord and to say, you know, the Lord is good and his mercy endures forever.
Yeah.
And just sing certain songs that are just about describing who Father is and what it is he's doing and who we are in response to what he did. I mean, those are great patterns right there. But and could go a long way. But Father did something even more. He's like, you know, saying it through his only begotten Son, Jesus, I'm looking for true worshipers. I want this to be by the Holy Ghost.
Yeah.
And so all we're doing is we're saying we're giving you an opportunity to hook up in faith with God, not to be insecure or threatened or to be overwhelmed by some kind of, you know, not get the pressure on you to perform, but just to engage and just in real simple things. Lord, I love you and I thank you that you love me and you're amazing and things like that. But make it verbal. Every person, everyone, no one left out, don't you? Don't you stand there and not participate. Because it's wrong. It's wrong. It's the stuff that doesn't even get in the garage. It's wrong. It's wrong. It's not fitting for his house. And if you'll consecrate yourself to these things tonight and just say, you know what? From this day forward, I'm going to give myself to God in this way. I am going to give myself to a realm of participating with him so that faith can be that which it's supposed to be. That if anybody even gets into the parking lot and they've got some kind of sickness or disease, they're going to be healed. I'm going to move in faith. I'm going to move in expectation in God. I'm going to move in confidence in God. Hallelujah.
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 Praise the Lord.
Thank you, Jesus. Kota robo kubrita pa ambrosa. Ming ambrori na manika.
You know, when we begin to worship and we begin, you know, just to begin to sing by the Spirit as we did tonight, you've already heard tongues and interpretation of tongues and prophecy and exhortation. And it doesn't need to just be me and Joshua, a few others. Because as soon as that happens, you can actually start flowing on the wind of it, the move of it. And we're dedicated to helping you in every way. But, you know, you can, you know, I've heard, you know, my mother used to say this often. She said, she'd tell me, in response to what was going on in church and things in ministry, she said, look, son, you can only lead a horse to water. You can't make them drink. If they want to stand in front of the trough and stare at it, there's nothing you can do about it. It's not even your responsibility. And, you know, I understand that. But I'm not happy with that. Who wants to be around a bunch of horses can't drink? And saying we're moving in the move, we're moving with God. Eh? We're not going to do that. Amen?
Yes.
Everybody's drinking in this place tonight.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Now, that's beautiful. That was wonderful. And that was good. How everybody just began to pray with other tongues. And that was real. Now, you need to become that fluent with the understanding also. Because if I then follow up right with that, excel and start praying out of the understanding and the same flow of the Spirit, where it's literally bypassing my intellect, it's bypassing anything that I think. There's not a lot of folks in this place, in any place, that can follow that. It's true. I watch people get in meetings and be in ministry where they're, you know, everybody's falling out and everybody's, you know, got various different manifestations. But really, when it comes to moving in the anointing and moving in authority in the framework of talking to Father, which I think that is the greatest expression of moving in authority, to be able to properly talk to Father, to fluently talk to Father by the Holy Spirit, there's such revelation there. There's such grace there. There's such insight there. There's such strengthening there. There's such faith there. There's not a lot of people that can keep up with that. And so I pray in the name of Jesus that you will excel.
Amen.
And that you will covet to excel, that you will do this. I just recently did a book, a little booklet, and it's available for you right now on our website. And it's called Tongues, the Language of the Holy Spirit. And I can understand why some people have major problems with tongues in church, because many of them don't really result in anything. They don't excel. It isn't producing what God intended for it to produce. It's a divine hookup with the Holy Spirit so that all of those expressions and manifestations of the Holy Ghost can be realized in our life. You have to place a demand on yourself to have that. You, because God placed a demand on you. You got to place a demand on yourself to have that. And it goes a long ways. Throughout the week, if you're just saying, Father, I want you to use me in your house, because I don't think there's any more important place to be used than in the house of the Lord. I mean, his church is glorious. It's in the church that he placed all of these gifts. The church is that which was purchased with his own blood. It's the place that he has built and the realm that he has established that the gates of hell cannot prevail against. It's a place where we're built up. It's a place where we're taught to observe all that he's commanded us. It's a place where we're perfected and we're equipped to do the work of the ministry. That's what the church is about. It's what we're about. Hallelujah. And so it's going to become the most important place for you to participate with the Holy Spirit. And I know that everybody in this place, and probably many of you that are watching me by web right now, you've already read enough and heard enough sermons to understand what it means to participate with the Holy Spirit. Then all you have to do is start asking yourself, well, why isn't that happening? What's in the way? And I'm gonna minister some tonight on that. I ministered some this morning on that. And, you know, just dealing with the whole issues of condemnation and shame and how that really people have got to stop living in the performance-based relationship and the concept of how well they're doing as the basis for how they interact with God and how they think God feels about them, because His mercy is something that He gives to us that we don't deserve. And if you can understand the first usage of mercy in context with Lot, I mean, my goodness, the Lord will give mercy to all of those who walk in His ways. That is another level. If He's going to give mercy to somebody like Lot and his family, what do you think He's going to do in terms of the mercy that He's given to the people who want to walk with Him and want to know Him, want to lay hold on Him, want to do it His way? Mercy just went to a whole nother level. I mean, mercy just went to a whole nother level. Mercy just went to a whole nother level. Because really, we don't even have an existence outside of Jesus. So all of our interaction with Him is based upon who Jesus is, not upon who we are. The Lord never deals with us in that realm. He deals with us in His mercy. That's undeserved. He's not impressed with you. And if that bums you out, I'm so sorry, because you don't even exist. Outside of Christ Jesus, you're not acceptable outside of Jesus.
Amen.
And if that makes you feel bad in some way, I'm sorry. Well, I'm not really sorry. I'm sorry for you that you don't get it, and that stuff has got to be broken out of your life.
Amen.
It is the most wonderful thing and most free, most, you know, place of liberty and freedom that I know of, to be the fact that I just exist in Jesus. And that He exists in me. And that I've got His life. No problem in trading my life for His.
Amen.
I'm so happy I don't get to interact with God on the basis of who I am.
Amen.
I mean, what's the problem? What's the problem? That should be joy and rejoicing. I get to interact with Father on the basis of who Jesus is. I'm in Him and He's in me.
Amen.
Hallelujah. And thus He's all my righteousness. He's all of my holiness. He's my divine ability. He's my ministry. He's my life. He's my purpose. And as I move in God, I'm just moving in Christ Jesus. It's the Lord Jesus that does the work. And I want everybody in this place to grab a hold of this. I want you to let God use you. I want you to let God use you. Let Father use you. Amen. Well, praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. I'm going to tell you why many people aren't in church tonight. I'm going to tell you why many people aren't in church tonight. Because of spiritual wickedness. Not necessarily because they got involved in some kind of terrible sin, but because of spiritual wickedness. Because of fiery darts. That's why many people aren't in church tonight. Thanks, everyone. Hallelujah. Tonight, I want to help you to begin to deal with more effectively the fiery darts of the wicked one. Hallelujah. Kura bastakita dolomo sabra. So go ahead and open up your Bibles with me to Ephesians. Praise the name of Jesus. Hey, we're getting a whole new sound system. I'm like, when is it going to get here? I can adjust everything from my laptop or from my iPhone, and oh my goodness, I'm just, thank you, Father. The reality of it is we could have done it a long time ago. It's just that I really just, you know, didn't just move out in faith and say, oh, we're just going to do it. Well, I mean, the other night I was here and I was frustrated, and the Spirit of the Lord started speaking to me. Why are you so frustrated? Sound. It's your fault. I'm thinking, it's my fault. And then they're like, suddenly the lights come on. Oh, I'm supposed to get the sound system. Okay. So I announced, well, we're going to go ahead and get the sound system. Now we got the sound system. Praise God. The order gets placed on Monday. Hallelujah. Tonight we're going to receive an offering later on tonight for the untouchables and the orphans in India and also the orphans in Nepal. And I'm just believing the Lord to be able to take it up to another level of giving. We'll do it once a month, this time of the month, every month that goes by. And so I just want you to be believing God for what you're going to be able to do in that realm. And if you need to save in that realm, or, you know, I wouldn't say go collect bottles. I believe that that's a usage of your time. And if you go collect bottles and you turn them in, you know, you're going to get what? You know, maybe what? You know, if you collected a lot of bottles, who knows? You may even get up to $100. That's a lot of bottles, right? If you would have rather taken that time and got on your face and begin to cry out to God, oh, you would have done way more than $100, way more than $100. But a lot of times people, if given the opportunity of either going and getting in place of prayer and touching the realms of faith, they would rather go pick up bottles because they feel like they're doing something more. And so I want to discourage you from doing bottles or any other fundraisers, okay, that is really out of the realms of the arm of flesh and the spirit of poverty, huh, and human ability. And rather take a hold of the supernatural divine power of an almighty God who has everything. He's got it all. He's the one who holds the purse strings for every bit of wealth and finances known in the earth today. And if he would like to get that to you, he would like to get that to you, but if you cooperate in faith so that he can supply it to you, then it will be yours. Until then, you get what you earned. And Father wants to bring you into a place of having what you did not earn. At what you could ill afford and what you do not deserve. And it's in every dimension of life. And I just pray that you'll grab a hold of these things. But it is just however it is that you move out. I pray it's not fundraisers. I pray it's not collecting bottles. I pray it's just in simply grabbing hold of faith and recognizing that as you give, Father's going to multiply it. Tonight as you give, the offering is, you know, we're going to take a special offering just for this purpose. And, you know, what we could do is, from a church perspective, we could say, oh, well, we got this need, and we got that need, and we got these things going on and building the church in Oregon. There's got a list of things. You know, we really just, it's not going to be convenient to take an offering at this time of the month or every month. Let's make it every other month, and then every other month to turn in once a quarter, then that'll turn in once a year, then it'll disappear altogether. We don't do things and move in God in the realms of convenience. We do it in terms of faith. So that it wasn't too long ago, and the Spirit of the Lord spoke to me, and he says, this is what I want you to do. And so I'm describing to you or declaring to you what God showed me by instruction that we were supposed to do. Now, in participating with him, when you do it, then there's a miracle there. When you participate with God's word, faith comes in that, in the midst of that, as soon as you obey. It's not something that you've got to try to beg God to have and try to, you know, God, increase my faith. No, you just obey God's word and you move with him, and immediately then you begin to be a beneficiary of faith. Yes. And in this particular instance, it's supernatural faith. Yes. Let me just tell you real quickly about the untouchables. The untouchables in India are a class of people that not even the Hindus want anything to do with. The government wants nothing to do with them. So there are a group of people, and there are literally hundreds of thousands of them in a nation of well over a billion people, okay? And so if you have a group of people mobilized to reach the untouchables, any untouchable that you go and take care of is going to give their life to Jesus. So every dollar represents a soul and the establishment of souls and the multiplication of it. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
And then what happens is you start giving to the untouchables like that, and the Lord will give you a burden for them. And if, you know, if you're, you know, willing to obey God and move with Father in it, you may end up being a missionary to the untouchables yourself. That's, yeah, you could giggle a little bit about that. Because really, most people in the United States of America That's a different lifestyle altogether. You have to learn how to live an entirely different life. The hygiene, there is no hygiene.
No.
But, you know, that's something that people learn, and they learn slowly. It doesn't just happen overnight. But we got people right now. We got an army right now of amazing people that we're helping to resource, and we're helping to fund, and they're going to go do this work. Hallelujah. And they're suited for it. And they're happy to do it. And God's multiplying them in an incredible way, and so we're going to support them. And then, of course, what we're doing, and they also do the particular group that we right now are partnering with, the Spirit of the Lord told me to partner with at the first of the year. This also has an orphanage, and we've been there, we've ministered there. Cade's been there, Ruthiana, and Ann has been there with me. And then, of course, you know what we're doing in Nepal, and the things that we purpose to do in Nepal. It's even to get bigger with orphanages. But yeah, hallelujah. Might as well,
Z's been there.
Might as well start. Yeah, Z was there. He didn't see much. He had a bad seat. His seat didn't have a view. It didn't come with a view. Hallelujah. Praise God. I want to teach you by the Spirit of the Lord tonight to war a good warfare. Amen.
Yes.
Hallelujah. I want to teach you tonight how to not be stopped with all that God has given you. You know, it's like having a bank account and you no money to spend and having all these resources of things that you can hand out but no hands to give it with. You know, Father wants to resource you tonight with respect of understanding how to shut down the lies. You know, wouldn't it have been amazing if when Satan said to Eve, "Hath God not said," that she would have responded and said, "God most certainly did say." If she would have opened her mouth and spoken the word, she would have been able to quench the fiery dart of the wicked one. Because what Satan does, and I want you to look there with me in that verse of scripture in Ephesians chapter 6 and verse 17. Forgive me, verse 16. And understand that the shield of faith, above all things, superior to all things. Ephesians chapter 6, some of you looking at me like I said Ephesians chapter 20. Ephesians chapter 6 and verse 16. Above all things, most importantly, in other words, take up the shield of faith, and which is able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked one. And I want you to understand that these are unique fiery darts, because this is something that when it comes into you, it begins to burn in your being. It begins to burn. It's a fire that begins to rage. It's a fire of lie, and it's a fire of deception that will burn up all the truth. It's a crazy fire. The fire or dart that hit Eve is burning unto this day, and you see the ashes everywhere, don't you?
Yes.
You see the consequences of that fiery dart. And that's really, when you look at warfare, back in ancient times during the days of Paul, they would use these kinds of tactics. So this is not something, you know, this isn't some big, huge, you know, spear that's, bomb, as it were, that's thrown by the catapult. This is a fire, this is a dart, this is a fiery dart. But here it is, it's like dipped in this pitch, but it's a demonic pitch. It's a flame, as it were, of spiritual origin I hate to use supernatural in application of demonic, so I'm always looking for another word, but it's spirit power, demonic spirit power that comes and it burns. And it burns in a way that destroys the things that God has purposed to do through you in the realms of truth, which is effectively how faith works. Faith works off of truth. Faith works off of the Word of God. It's truth that you agree with. It's truth that you trust in. And when you begin to talk about faith, it's made up. Faith is made up of the agreement of the ingredients of agreeing with God, recognizing that what He said is true, and recognizing that you can trust Him. Because He's not telling you something that is for your destruction, or something that is going to trick you, or something that is going to work some terrible thing in your life. It's something that's going to work preservation in your life. It is going to work blessings in your life.
Yeah.
And so it's agreement, it's trust, it's truth, it's all of these wonderful things that really the Word of God is describing to us. We watch Jesus deal with the fiery darts of the wicked one and the temptations that he had in the wilderness, when it's almost like these subtle questions. But you know, as I understand, in ancient times, what they would do to deal with these various different fiery darts and fiery arrows, you know, the various different types and kinds that they used, is they would soak their shields in water, and that would be the only way that they would be quenched. I mean, it's a pretty good typology, you know, with respect to drinking of the water of the Spirit, you know, and the water of the Word. But it's more than that. It is something that belongs to the supernatural power of God that is ours. It belongs to us right now. If you look in the scripture, you'll find over and again, beginning in Genesis chapter 15 and verse 1, that God is a shield. Yeah. Oh Lord, you are shield to me. You're my glory and the lifter of my head. You know, the psalmist says it over and again. The prophets say it over and again. It's not like any other kind of shield. It's a full body shield. He talks about a shield. You're my shield and you're my buckler. In other words, it's a full body shield that is there. And then the buckler is somebody who's there as an aid unto you that brings another shield to help protect you where your shield isn't working. Here he is wanting to help us deal with the things that are adverse, set against us, that Satan, who is as a roaring lion, comes out to devour us. Whom Father says we must resist steadfast in the faith. But if you don't know what the faith is, then you're not going to be able to resist him. If you don't if you're not careful, an offense can be a fiery dart. A word that somebody said to you can just burn. It burn on the inside of you. It can be various different kinds of temptation that burn on the inside of you. You don't know how to resist it. But reality of it is, I think that Luther said it very, very well. One little word shall fail him. One little word shall quench it all, stop it all. One little word. You're going to have to learn how to speak the Word of God and say, wait a minute, there are things that going on in my life that I've been yielding my members to. I've been yielding my thoughts to. There are ways that I think, the way that I process. If I hear somebody say the wrong thing, and if you're around me, if you're close to me, I'll ask you, if you say something, you know, if I've just spoken a word of faith, or I've just spoken something about moving in God, something spiritual, and you say something that in any way makes it sound like to me that you're putting up a hurdle, I say, did you just create a hurdle? God, I don't even want to hear that nonsense. You're hanging out with the wrong person now. Because you, what's going on is you're trying to bring your doubt and your unbelief into the program on the team called faith. And you can't play. You got to go over to your ball field called doubt and unbelief. We over here playing another sport. Yes. Hallelujah. We're over here occupied with something else. Advancing the kingdom of God, moving in signs and wonders and miracles. We're not interested in your hurdles. We're not interested in your yeah buts. We're not interested in your calculation. We're not interested in your human reasoning. We're not interested in your accounting methods of men. Not interested. You disqualified. You're burning with a fiery dart and you don't know it. You didn't know. It already hit you and you didn't know it. And it's burning and there's a bunch of ashes there. And it comes out as expressions of human ability, human effort, human understanding, human concern, human need. And Father wants to do a work in everybody's life to understand how that those things can be reset. So that if a fiery dart is already burning you, some kind of offense, some kind of strife, some kind of doubt, some kind of unbelief, some kind of wrong way of thinking, wrong way of behavior, wrong way of activity, he wants to cure that for us tonight. He wants to hit the reset button, so to speak. He wants to put the fire out, you know, that kind of fire out. And so he does. He calls us into this place by saying, be conformed to the image of Christ. So if I obediently respond to that, I say, no, I'm going to do it your way, Lord, then that's going to begin to bring up all of these wrong ways of thinking and wrong behaviors and wrong ways that we move in this life that we're supposed to be living in him. But if we're not passionate about that and we're not real about that and we're not giving ourselves to that, there's never going to be any revelation of how off we are. And we'll continue on never making any headway. And it's about time we start making some headway. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. Laying hands on everything that moves.
Amen.
And doing it by an anointing. Huh? You know what? What I'll do is, I'm just say this before I get into this, just because I want to make a point of this. I'll start talking to people. You know, if somebody has a need or whatever, and they present this need, I'll start talking. I ask them basic things: what's your name? Where are you from? What do you believe in God for? Just saying that. I want to hear them talk, because as I am hearing them talk, then what goes on is the Spirit of the Lord will activate in me the anointing if there's truth. If there's something supposed to happen. So I'm going to do something out of the realms of His manifest presence. I'll feel the anointing. I'll feel an authority. Miracles. The presence of the Lord has a feel to it. The movings of God. The rivers of God have a feel to it. I'm not going to move just because somebody told me to move. I've got a very clear contrast between me doing something on my own and doing it by the supernatural power of God. I was with a wonderful man of God that if I mention his name, everybody in this place would know who I was talking about, and the people that are watching on web. And I was with him with another man who was even more famous in the kingdom of God. Once again, if I mention his name, everybody would know it. But I don't want to. I just want to leave it there. And this man of God that I was with this greater man of God, said to the greater man of God, where there was really a request made, and I think it actually came from one of the wives, please lay your hands on the son of the man of God that was there visiting with the greater man of God. And the greater man of God didn't respond. And it was asked him again. He said, you're not my God. I love the boy. I love you guys. I'm having you here. But leave it. And people can say that that's rude and that's insensitive. But this isn't the same thing as what you do in your everyday life of getting somebody something to drink or get them a little present or doing a little something special or saying a little nice thing. This belongs to the sacred things of God. And it's not for men to tell God what to do. It's for men to learn how to hear the voice of the Lord and begin to move with the Spirit of the Lord, to become sensitive to Him. Religion isn't going to make you sensitive to the Holy Spirit. It's simply not. It's going to be a performance-based thing, and it's going to be all about you, and you're basically, it's going to be about what you can do and about what you can have and really what you bring to the table within the framework of your resources. That's not what we're interested in. We're interested in moving in faith. Yes. We're interested in moving in the Spirit of God, and we've got to recognize that faith overcomes the world. You look at that verse of Scripture, for example, in 1 John chapter 5, is it verse 3? This is the overcoming power that overcomes the world, even our faith. And when you know that, you recognize, wait a minute, what do you think Satan is going to be launching his primary attacks against? He's going to launch his primary attacks against faith. And faith really is found in the way that we agree with God, the way that we agree with His Word, the way that we live by His Word, the way that we speak His Word. I'm always trying to get people to speak, because you can't have anything that you can't talk about. You're going to talk about it, you're going to speak it before you're ever going to have it. And if people just sit in silence, I'm sorry that somebody, you know, constantly reproved you and buffeted you all the way through the school process to turn you into this silent, you know, scared person. But God has liberated you by the power of the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. So that you now, instead of being conformed to the image of men, and so to be conformed to a Western society and a Western culture, anybody who believes that the Western culture somehow is superior to all other cultures, you're just wrong. You're just wrong. There are many other cultures that I would rather live in just from certain value points of view than a Western culture. But I've got a greater culture than all the cultures of men. It's the culture of the kingdom of God. Listen, and the culture of the kingdom of God is uniquely different from the culture of men, as heaven is from hell. Or if the contrast is heaven is from earth. You don't even have to go that deep. Pun intended. It's just as different as heaven is from earth, so is the culture of the kingdom of God from the culture of the kingdom of men. And what's happened is there's been fiery darts that have been able to be launched effectively against you and I to where that we have now been adapted, we've adapted and agreed with and move and act upon the cultures that we've learned and the rules that were set by men, and that becomes our prison. And the Lord wants us to come over into a realm of walking with Him and recognizing that He is the Almighty God, that He is all-powerful with unlimited power, that before the mountains were be brought forth, before ever the earth was, He was there. He's from everlasting to everlasting. Amen. Everything and all the resources are His. Amen. He made it all by His own power. Amen. There is nothing that exists outside of the realm of His creation and that which He brought forth. Amen. He owns every penny, every dime, every dollar, every ounce of gold, every ounce of silver, every precious thing, every jewel, every cattle, every beast, every living thing. It's His. It belongs to Him. When He says so, every bit of your body is cured. If He says so, you'll live 10,000 years. You'll live 10,000 to be 10,000 years old. Whatever He says. No. Whatever He says. Whatever He says about you right now. About me right now. And that's the crisis. Because there are fiery darts that are being thrown by the wicked one to try to get us to believe something else. To where we cannot make that His all-powerful person with all that He has purposed to do, because He has it all and wants to give it to you and me. There's fiery darts that bring that into question, so that can't be. There's fiery darts that are working against the reality of what God has done for us and what He's given to us that would prevent us from being able to participate with it. And you're going to have to lift up your head and get your hands lifted up and get yourself a smile on your face. Yeah. Number one, even begin to participate. But there's a fiery dart that will stop that down, to shut that thing down too. To where there's nothing about the manner, there's nothing about the behavior, there's nothing about the disposition or the demeanor of God that you're able to participate with. Even unto the smile. Even unto the joy. That it just takes, it really doesn't hardly even take a fiery dart. But the Lord, but you know. It's true. But the enemy of your soul throws one anyways. Just say you're sad all day. So let me give you some 2020 vision. 1 Chronicles, what is it? 1 Chronicles, is it, I know it's, I'm pretty sure it's 1 Chronicles. I'm pretty sure it's 1 Chronicles. If it's not 1 Chronicles, it's 2 Chronicles. Check real quick. Chapter 20, verse 20. 1 Chronicles, chapter 20, verse 20, give you some 2020 vision. 2 Chronicles? Yeah, gong isn't the appropriate word. That's fine, but nonetheless, moving right along. 2 Chronicles, verse 20, 20, verse 20. If you'll believe the Lord, so shall you be established. Am I saying it right? If you believe the Lord, so shall you be established. I haven't gotten that yet. I haven't gotten that yet because I'm doing good just speaking in the English language. Hallelujah. But if you will believe the Lord, so shall you be established. If you'll listen to what His prophet says, so shall you prosper. Huh? And that wasn't said in just some kind of touchy-feely little place. Listen, guys, if you'll just believe the Lord, so shall you have a nice little home to live in. And you'll, you know, hearkening to the voice of the prophets, so shall you prosper. And then just have more food on the table. This is about your life. You're going to go out there and die. Because God's remedy for this situation is that what He wants you to do, the new weaponry, the new military strategy He has for you today, is you're going to go out and worship and praise. Huh? And so what is it putting you in? It is putting you in a crisis to where, an intense crisis, right? Where we really got to believe God. We really got to trust God. Because what we're going to do is we're going to go sing to the enemy. The enemy has come out against us with iron chariots and come out with against us with great weapons of war. And our strategy is we're going to go sing a song to them. But reality of it is we're going to sing a song to the Lord. Yes. And we're going to worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. Amen. And that's in that sense, it's in the beauty of being consecrated unto Him. relying upon Him, trusting in Him. And you don't tell me that there's all kinds of thoughts and all kinds of intimidations that are going to be coming against that. And once again, people, if it's anything that is going to be, that is going to result in somehow you're not being willing to trust God and move in faith, it's by definition in this verse of Scripture a fiery dart. And Father has given us the ability to put every one of them out so that they cannot burn in us, so that they cannot affect us, so that they cannot influence us. And then He tells us over and again that He Himself is our shield. Can we get a fiery dart through Him? Try to get a fiery dart through the Almighty God. He tells us He Himself is our shield. But over and again, people, it's not really worked out for a lot of people. In the history, it's not worked out in the history of man. It's not worked out for a lot of people. Within respect to the history of the church, it's not worked out for a lot of people. In respect to the modern day experiences right now, and maybe perhaps even in your own life. Because you didn't know that the only reason that you couldn't prophesy is because of fiery dart. You didn't know that the only reason that you couldn't move in that place of being sensitive to the Holy Ghost is because of fiery dart. You didn't realize that the only reason that you couldn't connect with that wonderful supernatural thing called the body of Christ, that connectivity that gets you right in place where what's going on with Jesus right now is flowing to you. And that's a beautiful thing. Believe me. Let me tell you, it's beautiful. It's a wonderful thing to be directly connected with the head, Christ Jesus, and have what He's supplying flowing directly to you, because you're connected by the Holy Spirit with the body of Christ, with Him, with God's people, and thus with Him. And it was a fiery dart that kept you from it. And so many people have had this fire burning, this fire of deception, because it's deception, and this fire of a lie burning in them for years. And it's created ashes. And it's not been beauty, it's been ashes. And Father wants to work a miracle for you and show you and reveal to you. And the only way He can work the miracle and show you and reveal to you something that has been able to take a hold of you and influence you is your willingness to bow before the Word of God and say, okay, Father, I want this in my life, and I'm not going to have anything else. I mean, if I walked under the rule of faith and love, and you can understand in 1 Thessalonians, I believe it's 5, chapter 5, verse 8, where Paul says, putting upon the breastplate of righteousness and of faith and love, putting on the breastplate of faith and love. I mean, if we can just understand, if I would walk into the rule of being clothed with His love, of walking in love, imitating God and walking in love, if there's anything the Father says over and over again, it's that. It's a command over and over again. It's a description over and over again of His unlimited love and His unlimited mercy and His unlimited grace that is extended to all of us. And in that, He's telling you and I, listen, I command you, I demand of you to walk in this love. And if you're not going to walk in the love, you're never going to be my disciple. You're not going to be following me. If you're not following Him, you can never do the things He's doing. Because following Him is being directly hooked up with His lordship, His leadership, His authority, His power, His divine grace. And if I'm not going to do these things, then I'm not walking with Him. I'm not receiving what He's supplying. Hear me. Yeah. And it's not just any kind of love. It is that supernatural love and supply of the Spirit that every one of us in this place tonight want to touch a deeper realm of it, because to know the love of Christ which passes knowledge causes you and I to be filled with all the fullness of God. The blessing of it. And plus, it's such a beautiful life to live. What an amazing thing, you know. To just walk around unencumbered by all of the problems and all of the issues and all the complaints and all the unforgiveness and all the concerns about how people feel about you, whether or not they like you. If you like me, check yes in the box. And you're sending this out right and left, and then you're so insecure, you need somebody to tell you every 5 minutes, check the box yes again. Yes, I do love you. Yes, 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 I love you. Please call me and tell me. I know you're going to go down the road. You're going to be gone 10 minutes. I need you to tell me that you love me at least 5 times while you're gone. Do you have your cell phone with you? Insecurity, fear driven. Why? Because a fiery dart has penetrated you and it's burning in you with a demonic influence that's turning everything into ashes, that's burning up all of the beauty and the splendor of the life that Jesus purchased for you at Calvary. And you need to get mad enough tonight. Yes. And you need to get angry enough tonight. Yes. and you need to get fed up tonight.
Yeah.
So you'll take your shield of faith, hallelujah, which is an intimacy with the Lord, which is a reliance upon the Lord, which is simply you taking the word of God, for one little word shall stop him.
Yes.
One little word. Shall fail him. One word. That's all Jesus did. It's one little word from heaven. Not my word, his word. Somebody comes along, a fiery dart comes along and say, you sick. Let not the inhabitants of the Lord say, I'm sick. You can say I am, but I'm not. I'm not going to say I am. I'm gonna make sure that every word that comes out of my mouth, which he knows and hears and understands altogether, is going to be words of blessing and words of faith and words of proclamation of those things which he said. I'm going to stick with what God said. I'm not going to be a false prophet to myself. People always run around, oh, false prophets, false prophets. How do we know it's not a false prophet? You're the biggest false prophet that you know. If everything that you were saying about yourself and what's going to happen to you was recorded, you'd go, my goodness gracious, this person got terrible doctrine. Then somebody say, no, that's you. We just recorded you, wrote it down. And most all of those terrible things that people say really are out of the realms of fear. And the Lord has released us from the bondage of fear. Amen. And put into our hearts the spirit of the Son, whereby we're saying, God's my dad. Who's concerned? God's my dad. Who's worried? God's my dad. So there's nuclear bombs going off all over the place. Who's worried? God's my dad.
Amen.
I'm never going to bow to anything that Satan is doing, to any of his fears, and neither will I burn. Neither will men be able to destroy me. Whatever they do, it cannot harm me. And hey, if the Lord should allow me to be killed, my goodness gracious, talk about a wonderful blessing. Because I immediately step into the glory and the splendor of being in his presence without my physical body, but there's still a tabernacle ready for me so that I'm not unclothed. I don't know what that looks like. It's going to be looking like me, though.
Yeah.
But it's still a tabernacle. It's a temporal tabernacle that is described in 2 Corinthians chapter 5. Yeah? Until I get to wait for the ecstasy of the resurrection in my body, which is even another dimension of glory.
Yeah.
Man, I'm telling you right now, there's a whole bunch of glory happening up here. There's a whole bunch of glory happening. There are some exciting milestone events that you want to be preparing for rather than just trying to save up for your next vacation. I'm telling you, some of them so much better than your next vacation is about to take place, and it's just going to keep getting better and better. Among men, all good things come to an end. Among God, all good things keep getting better. Hallelujah! Hallelujah. I learned something not too long ago from a man who doesn't even know the Lord. Showed me more of a positive disposition about life than many of God's people. And I would ask him every time I'd see him, I'd ask him how he was doing. You know, and he's an old kind of a guy, barely seeming to get around. I'd ask him how he's doing. He'd always say, better than good. And he would say with excitement, better than good. Man, I need to get you into relationship with the living God so you can understand what better than good is. And he really didn't have much of an ear to hear because he was raised in Catholicism and everything else. And there's such a deception there. And it says, listen, we got to put all of it together. And we don't really need to do much over here. And we just go to confession, yada, yada. We don't really have to conform to the image and the likeness of Christ Jesus. But my goodness. I mean, praise God that there's somebody on earth that's just a little bit of the similitude of God still resident there in that life. And all, just if I could just get all of God's people to start saying, start being like shocking people of how well you're doing instead of walking around. And then when you say something is so stupid, you know what I'm saying? It's so weird. It's an awkward moment. Come on, let God make your tongue as a pen of a ready writer. So that when you speak, it sounds like, wow, that is beautiful. There was thanksgiving in it. There was praise in it. There was something real in it. There was concern about the people around you, a sensitivity, a kindness, a love. If you let kindness and love rule your speech, you would talk differently. But people have a fiery dart burning in their emotions and in their passions has made nothing but ashes. And so they can't let kindness and love rule over them in their speech and in their behavior, what they say and how they interact with people. Oh, but I tell you, I think better things of you tonight. And those of you who've been beaten down and cast down and you're so insecure, you're ruled by a spirit called fear. And it's nothing other than that. And you can't try to say, oh, my insecurity isn't fear, it's genetics. Ha ha. My father was like this, and my grandfather and my great-grandfather, and on both sides of the family, my mother's that way, my dad's that way, and all their family was that way. My cousins are all this way. You all got the same demon ruling over you. And it had nothing to do with genetics. You give me that person, we'll get them born again, get them full of the Spirit, and show them how to take hold of the shield of faith, and they're going to be just as happy as Jesus. And they're going to be just as happy as the Holy Ghost. And they're going to have the same boldness and the same confidence and the same love for people. And there's not one iota of introvertedness in God nor in any of the angels of heaven. Not any. No insecurity in the Holy Ghost. He's just not insecure. Just isn't. He's not concerned about how whether you like him or not and how you feel about him, what you thought about the last thing he said. He's just not even concerned about it. He doesn't know checks in the box and he's handing another piece of paper and saying, if you like me, if you still like me, you know, put yes, check yes in the box. Oh, thank you. Isn't it good coming? Dude, what a mess. It's a mess. That's where long suffering really kicks in when I, you know, have to hang out with insecure people. Because, I mean, the thing about it is listen, please, shut up. It's just fear talking. It's insecurity. If you hang out with me, I'm going to tell you, it's terrible. It's kind of a hard thing for people to hang out with me. Because I'm not gonna tolerate it. I don't want it around me. Go talk to the tree. You can carry on a profitable conversation. But me, I wanna hear the nonsense. Because your tongue will become a fiery dart to me. And I'm not gonna take it in. I'm not gonna listen to it. People want me to empathize and sympathize with things that the demon power has created. I'm gonna cast it out. I'm like, oh, but I'm not a devil. I mean, you're not a bad devil. I mean, you're kind of a cute demon, and you know, I can understand, you know, that your misbehavior and your violence and your rage against humanity. I'm not doing it. I'm saying, stop that, right, you foul spirit. You quit oppressing and tormenting this person. But if you address that, but do not address the behavior and the attitude that gave entrance to that demon spirit, then it just keeps coming back. It keeps ruling. It keeps oppressing. It keeps reigning. Some point in time, people got to just obey God's word. People got to understand that Father has put them in the church to build them up, to perfect them. He's full of long suffering. He's full of mercy. He's not going to give you what you deserve. He's always going to give you something far better just by your asking, by your willingness to believe. But you're going to have to be willing to change. You're going to have to be willing to say, okay, I'm going to agree with God. I'm going to let somebody perfect me around here called the Holy Ghost. Yes. Yes. So I quit, you know, living the a Holy Ghost roller coaster ride. Today I'm happy. Tomorrow I'm sad. Last week, it was a wonderful week. I had an amazing week. This week has been terribly bad. I'm constantly under attack by demon spirits. What a terrible life to live. There's some folks that you ask them, how's it going? We're besieged by the powers of darkness. We're under attack of the darkness. Just another thing. Like, what? Why don't you move into heaven, man? Sounds like you like hanging out right on the borders of hell, if not hell itself. Satan has no right to even touch you. I mean, he's like a little kid. The more you acknowledge him, the more he acts up. He's a misbehaving little rascal. Just vying for your attention. Huh? He just laughs. Say, you foul spirit, get out of here in Jesus' name. Satan goes about as a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. God says, resist whom you are to resist steadfast in the faith. Because if you submit yourself to God, resist the devil, he'll flee away. If we understand faith and the confidence of faith and the boldness of faith that God has given to us, because we just simply believe what God says. We believe what the Lord says. And we hearken into what we believe what the Lord says, and we're established. And so everything that the wicked one and everything that people said is going to be done, all the bad things are going to take place, aren't going to happen because God says you're going to be blessed. And I'm going to believe what the Lord says, so I'm going to be established and blessed. Father said, I've given you my glory, I've given you my presence, I've given you my power, I've given you my authority, I put my blessing on every dimension of your life, spiritually, physically, Amen. Financially. Amen. It's yours, it's all yours.
Amen.
Something comes along and I love to brag about and talk about living in divine health, and something comes along, like came along last week, and my throat gets hit with this crazy little thing. You know, just tickle thing, and my goodness gracious, and it could be a fiery dart that all of a sudden threatens my proclamation of living in divine health. But the reality of it is, it's not my proclamation. It's God's proclamation that I've agreed with and that I'm speaking out and testifying to, and I lay hold on. Somebody said, what are you going to do now? I'm never going to have it again. That's what I'm going to do now. I'm making no provision for the next time. And you and I ought to you ought to get provoked in this place and say, how on earth did our pastor even get infected by anything? I'm outraged. Yeah. And start kicking some stuff around in here. Yeah. And be provoked that such an attack would happen. Yeah. Against the church, against me. Yeah. Against you. Yeah. Against anyone. Yeah. Where's the zeal? You with me? Because why? Because we know what God has done. And there's nothing but Satan coming around, messing around, trying to kick things around, trying to take, you know, dominance over the place. And there's no way I'm not going to take that. You're not going to take that. Unless you've been infected. Unless a fiery dart has come and now it burns within you a deception or a lie that says, well, this is just commonplace. It's ordinary. No big deal. Who am I anyways to pray? Who am I to get all violent about opposing the powers of darkness? Who am I to rise up in the authority of God Almighty? Because after all, this fiery dart's burning with deception in my spirit, and I can't think any other way. Am I being clear? Am I breaking this down for you? You go ahead and giggle a little bit. If I'm not thinking like the Word of God describes me to be thinking, then there's something wrong. If I'm not behaving like the Word of God has described that I should be behaving, if I'm not having the inspirations that the Word of God says is mine, if I don't have the river that is flowing that God has provided, then there's something running interference with that. And I can see right here in this verse of Scripture that one of those things, and probably above all other things, it is the lies, the subtle lies and deception of the enemy. That's really where it's at. And it's got to be shut down in my life.
Amen.
But what if it's burning right now? Then I need deliverance. Then I need help. And the greatest deliverance is repentance. It says, Lord, forgive me for having those attitudes that are contrary to the ones that the Holy Ghost produced. Father, forgive me for having those behaviors that are contrary to the ways of the behavior of the Holy Spirit. Father, forgive me for having that kind of disposition. And that... Those kinds of actions, those kinds of deeds. And in that, that's deliverance. It's liberation. Because you know what the Lord does? He says, well, talk to me next week. I'm busy right now. That's what he does, right?
No.
That's good, thank you. A couple of people said no. The people didn't say no. They're still wondering. Fire dart's burning. It's burning. So they can't say no. They can't say yes. Maybe can't even shrug their shoulders. They're neutral. It's called non-responsive. It's despondent. Huh? Right? Vital signs. Check them. It just goes on everywhere, you know. Like I heard preachers tell jokes about it. They called 911 because somebody died in the meeting and they had to go through several rows of people to finally find the right one. Because people are just in the church. They're just non-responsive. They're despondent. They don't even know how to respond to God. It's another realm. It's not an earth realm. You're comfortable in the earth realm. Somebody's running with the football. You know what to do. Tackle them or run. Go, go, go. Or somebody do this thing. The earth realm. It's earthly things. It's earthly interest. You know what to do. You can participate. You're all in. You know what to do. But now it's spiritual. It's in the realms of heaven. What do we do now? How do we respond? How do we act? What's our proper behavior? God, the Holy Ghost is here to teach us.
Yes. Amen.
So long as there's no fiery darts burning on the inside of us with lies and deception.
Amen.
It's about time to understand now how to shut that thing down and how no longer to be influenced. And the powers of darkness are raging against us. And the beautiful thing of it is, you look back at verse 10, it says, be strong. And it says, be strong. And just and think about understanding this verse of scripture like this. In the strength and the power of the Lord. Think about how strong and powerful our Almighty God is. And that He's for you. And you be strong in that. If you can't understand it any other way, you can be strong in saying, I serve a big, big God who's totally for me. He's my protector. He's my shield. And don't you mess with me. I tell you, if you bless me, He'll bless you. But if you curse me, He's going to curse you. I feel sorry for all of my enemies. He's taking care of me coming in and going out. Amen. He numbered the hair upon my head.
Amen.
Collects my tears in a bottle. Amen. Provides for me all that I have need of according Amen. To His riches and glory.
Amen. Hallelujah.
I don't even know how people don't have anything to say when it comes to praise.
Hallelujah.
I'm so filled with the Word of God. Why? Because I live by the Word of God and I speak the Word of God.
Amen.
And I can tell whether or not you live by the Word of God and speak the Word of God based upon how you're able to praise, whether or not it's coming out of your mouth. If it's not coming out of your mouth, it's because you're not living by the Word of God and speaking the Word of God. It's just true. It's a revelation. You could say that it isn't. It is. For out of the abundance of the heart and the mouth speaks. And what you really know well and what you're really comfortable with and what you give yourself to, I mean, you just flow. It just flows out of you.
Yes.
I mean, you got your wealth of information. You're a wealth of knowledge. God wants to make you a wealth of knowledge and inspiration and information about who He is.
Yes.
And about what He's doing.
Yes.
Hallelujah. If God did it a billion years ago, He'd do it today. Because He's unchanging.
Yes.
How much more if God did it yesterday, will He do it today?
Yes.
How much more if God did it 2,000 years ago, will He do it today?
Yes.
Anything God ever did in history is doing right now because He's the unchanging, immutable God. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever.
Yes.
All those things are as a witness to us to know and understand what we can expect right now. Hallelujah. And the more you talk about it, the more you get excited about it, the more the reality of it is in your life. And no longer are you influenced by fiery darts. And a fiery dart comes to try to steal your faith and confidence about finances. And all you do is lift your hands, start worshiping, and say, watch what God's going to do. It's another opportunity for Him to work a miracle for me. You fail or fall short in something and Satan comes with all of his lies and all of his condemnation. This is who you are and this is just who you're going to be. You're just always a failure and you're not walking with God. You're probably not even born again because if you were, you wouldn't be doing this so much. Fiery dart. And for many people, they don't know about the mercy of God. They don't know God enough to be able to even grab a hold of the shield of faith and lift it. They have no word to speak. It's the Word of God that is the shield of faith. It's the speaking forth of the Word of God that is the shield of faith. It's the declaration of His Word.
Yes.
And coming to understand that nothing is impossible for them to believe.
Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah. I tell you right now, I am very confident of what God is going to do in Southern California.
Yeah.
I'm always imposing things upon what He's going to do with respect to just talking about the glorious church that He needs, that He wants to have. I know what He needs and what He wants to have. He's described it. And so therefore, I'm laboring together with Him in that. He says, no, this is what I want, not that. And so I say to you, no, that's not what He wants. He wants this. And you're looking at me like, you know, you're all upset because I'm in your case. Well, it isn't. I'm not expressing my opinion.
Right.
Men out of the realms of the height of their intellect express their opinion. And that is meaningless.
Yeah.
Well, all we're doing is saying, this is what the pattern looks like. We're building the house and you're trying to tell me we can put up the roof without the walls. I'm saying, no way, we can't put the roof up without the walls, man. What are you talking about? And you're trying to tell me about some shortcuts about how we don't need to have headers. 1 2x4 will do. I'm saying, no way. Oh, we don't really need a foundation. We don't need to pour a footer there. It's going to be fine. We don't need to strap it down. Man, the first earthquake comes and the house kind of collapses on your head. You want to have it different. No, God's given us a pattern. He says, this is the way I want it. He says, I'll breathe on it. I want that when the sacrifice is right, I'll send my fire. He said, when the sacrifice is right, I'll send my fire. He said, when the sacrifice is right, I'll send my fire.
Yeah.
And so I'm a priest looking at the sacrifice going, no, you can't put it on there like that. You're going, oh, look, and she's never satisfied about it. He just doesn't like me. I know he doesn't like me. It has nothing to do with that. The sacrifice is taken wrong. To throw a Christian cuss word in. It's wrong. And stinking is appropriate. Because if the sacrifice sits there too long without fire, it's going to smell. You got to get that thing lit quick. And the hotter that it is, the hotter the day it is, the quicker you need to light that. Because you can skin it and flay it by morning, and by afternoon it's like, woo! This is not a sweet-smelling sacrifice. This thing stinks. So the priest is saying, no, you can't do it that way. You can't have an altar like that. No, you cannot arrange things like that. No, that is an inappropriate sacrifice. And people have got to be willing to learn. Instead of having a response that is a proof that you have a fiery dart that is on the inside of you, burning within your passions the rages of hell. Called offense. Rebellion, stubbornness, unforgiveness, despising authority, high-mindedness, pride. All of those things are fiery darts, dear people. It's for the wicked one to stop and shut down the move of God in our life, to shut down our ability to just simply open up and submit ourselves to God and receive the abundance of the grace that He's supplying. Now, I want you to listen to this. I'm going to give you a couple of verses of Scripture here. I just want you to hear some of these things. Hallelujah. Okay, you can giggle some. Hallelujah. 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 You know, Paul referred to, in 1 Thessalonians 3, verse 5, he referred to the tempter coming and tempting. Listen, Satan is the tempter, and he comes to tempt. He comes to lead people away, to steal from them the things that God has established for them to have. God's already sent it forth. He's already done the miracle to work it to where it's available to everyone, anyone who calls. Reality of it is you've got an enemy of your soul that you've got to be able to recognize. God's not tempting anyone. The temptation, everything that comes against you that tries to work in you something other, the behavior, something other than what Christ Jesus has done and is doing, something other than the fruits of the Holy Ghost, it's the tempter. Will you quit talking with him? Stop communing with him. In 1 Thessalonians 5:15, Paul's laying it out, just dealing with them about being in the truth and holding fast to the truth and staying in the doctrines which they have received. And he says, listen, guys, you better sharpen up over here, for some have already turned aside unto Satan. I mean, you talk about that, it's radical, right? We just say, oh, they're backslidden. No, Paul says, they're Satanists now. That's pretty radical, eh? You just say, oh, brother, I know the Lord still loves you. And because he does. But, you know, it's time for you to quit living in a backslidden state. No, the Lord is more radical with that. He's more, yeah. It's look, you're either walking with God or you're walking with Satan. You're either walking in truth or you're walking in a lie. We want to make it something less than it is. I want to be all in on God's side. I want to be all in for Him. I'm so happy just to exist. I don't want to exist in anything else. I want in every way have my life and my behavior and my manner of existence and my manner of living to be proof that I am in Him and He's in me. I'm not going to yield my members to something that doesn't look like divine power and glory. It doesn't matter if I pray for everybody and nobody gets healed. At least I'm doing what God said to do. Are you listening to me? And you need to do the same thing. You're going to really sit around and you're disobedient. And you want to have it your own way in your own time. And you need to get moving, church, and imitating God and doing what God said to do. He said, if you won't confess me before men and be ashamed of me around men, you're just trying to accommodate men in terms of what you say about me. He said, it's the same way I'm going to treat you before my Father, before the angels in heaven. And they're just going to say, I have no idea who he is. I'm embarrassed. The guy's weird. You know what I'm saying? Because that's it. They wouldn't understand. You would not understand. That's Jesus telling the angels and the Father about you. Because you're always like, they wouldn't understand if I talked. No, it's just nonsense, people. Become a blabbermouth, a signpost for Jesus Christ.
Yes.
Give yourself, give your life completely over to Him. But I hope you come, I hope you become one that's flowing in the Holy Ghost and not one that's just a religious ditty.
Right. Amen.
Huh?
Amen.
It's just, you know, ridiculous, saying ridiculous things and not in any way showing the love of God. You know, you can't be His witness until you're baptized in the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
You can't flow in the Holy Ghost if you've got fiery darts burning on the inside of you. You're going to have to understand, you've got to sharpen up. To sharpen up. You got to sober up, sharpen up. Your adversary, the devil, goes about as a roaring lion seeking whom he may devour. You're at war against him. You wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against spiritual wickedness. That's pretty radical. Huh? Somebody said, oh my goodness, did you see that? A bunch of witch doctors were camped out in front of my house doing all kinds of, you know, voodoo and hoodoo and what do you do? You know? And now you got everybody calling up everybody to pray. Oh God, help us. I cannot believe this. They got like dolls made in my image and they're like poking needles in and they're dancing around fire and they're like swallowing snakes and doing all kinds of weird stuff. You'd be on high alert. Talk about vigilant, talk about sharpening up. Evil. I'm telling you, something worse than that's going down around here. You wrestle against spiritual wickedness. I'm telling you, Satan, his purpose to take you down. He wants you, he can't take you down. He's going to shut you up. He's going to stop you up. He's not going to allow there to be any flow. He's going to make you look like the most ridiculous human being on the planet because you say Jesus. So he can totally disqualify you in the eyes of men. I'm not having that. There's got to be something beautiful. It's got to be something joyful. It's got to be something wrapped so nice. It's got to be something worthy of His name, worthy of His house. Hallelujah. I bring it into the place. I said, Father, you set this in your house, in your living room. It better be sharp. It better look good. Because otherwise, it's going to the garage. Hey, are you listening to me? Or it's going to go to, and we put a bunch of stuff out there. Goodwill, Salvation Army. Would you pick it up? I mean, there's some things Salvation Army came by and said, no, we don't want that. I'm like, and his Salvation Army doesn't want it. How on earth does Father want it? You know what I'm telling you over here? Listen to me. You got to quit being influenced by wrong imaginations and wrong thinking and wrong behavior. What we bring to Pops is the best.
Yes.
It's the very best of who we are and what we are and what we have to present. It's our best smile. It's our best praise. It's our best demeanor. It's our best behavior. It's our best of everything that we have. It's our best. It's excellent. It's beautiful. It's wonderful. And God, the Holy Ghost, takes that, He baptizes it in His fire, and He now makes it supernatural because it's Holy Ghost expressions. Because He saw me preparing and getting ready to bring my best. He saw how desperate I was. Father, I don't want it to be me. I want it to be you. I don't want to bring shame to your name. I want to bring honor and your glory to your name. And for me, it's not like, you know, dealing with sin here. It's just dealing with human stinking flesh. Stinking again. You know, but it is. It's a proper word. Human stinking effort of men. You know what? No. Lord, I don't want it to be that. I want it to be that only which only you can do. I want it to be that splendor which only you can produce. I want it to be that power and that authority which only you can bring to pass. And in our presentation to Him, hallelujah, the prophecy flows. The sweet songs of the Spirit flow. Hallelujah. Oh God, you are my God. You're all I want. You're all that I need. Jesus, take me. These songs are there. I mean, people, I know there's some people that can't sing very well, but you can write it out and you can rap it. I can rap some stuff. Huh? Hallelujah. I can start getting into some prayer. Oh God, you're good. And your mercy endures forever. You're wonderful, oh God. And you reign in my heart right now. Just come on, you bring it. Come on. Oh, Lord, the abundance of all that you've supplied. Oh, it goes beyond anything that I could have ever asked. It's so deep, so wide. Oh, mighty, mighty God, how good, how great, how wonderful. Come on. You don't have to have a voice to do that. You don't have to have a voice to do that. You got to have a passion. You got to have an inspiration. You got to have a source of inspiration. If a fiery dart is burning of lie and deception, it'll turn it all into ashes. That is inspiration. There won't be any there. That's true. Galatians chapter 3, verse 1 is fiery dart stuff. He says to the church in Galatians, oh, foolish Galatians, what a way to talk to the church on Sunday morning. Oh, you foolish bunch of people. How long? He said, look at. He says this, who has put the hocus pocus on you? No, bewitched to put the hocus pocus on somebody, to cast a spell. It's true. To believe something different than the gospel that was delivered to them. What is that? It's a fiery dart. It's burning on the inside. It's very subtle. It's just, goodness, it's a terrible, sore subject. Sore, emphasis on sore. We all got to go get circumcised. I mean, it's one thing to take the babies to get circumcised. It's another thing when you're 50 years old. Ouch. Sore subject. And these guys are buying into this, that the only way that they're going to be acceptable to God is they're going to go get the circumcised. Jesus, help us. It's a spell. It's the fiery dart, the wicked one. Hallelujah. It doesn't seem like much. It doesn't seem like much. It really doesn't seem like much. It's just a little bit of false doctrine. It's just a little bit of something that you bought into that changes your behavior and your manner of thinking about how God feels about you, whether or not He loves you, whether or not you're acceptable unto Him, whether or not you're one with Him, how much you can receive from Him, how much He's has afforded you, and on what basis. Fiery darts. Whatever Satan's got to do, whatever fiery dart he can subtly attack you with, that will begin to burn within you a lion deception. Ultimately, the same thing is going to be shut down, the river and the flow of the Holy Ghost, because the next thing he's going to take up is he's going to say, listen, he that works miracles among you by the Spirit, how does he do it? By the hearing of faith. He said, it's not by the human ability and the human effort. And what happened was a fiery dart had turned them to rely upon human effort and human ability in their walk with God. And I can tell you right now, I can break down all kinds of related type of beliefs that people have taken up. They may not be about circumcision, but they're about things that has changed the dynamics of how they're allowed to move in God or not. The supply of the Spirit that has been given to us to freely move in all the dimensions. This is supernatural power and divine ability. There's fiery darts that have touched people's lives that have clearly isolated them from the divine flow of the Holy Ghost. Father supplied to us the blood of Jesus so that we could be hooked up in oneness with Him and be acceptable unto Him. The blood of Jesus supplies us then with a proper response to the blood that in Him is all my righteousness and all my life. With the supplies us to where there's no condemnation, where there's no shame, where there's none of this offense, so that I can hook up with the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
If my response to the blood isn't right, I can't hook up with the Holy Ghost. I better watch out for some fiery darts. How am I going to know the difference? I need to be trained up in the Word of God, the Word of life. There is a protection there until ultimately the Lord gives you a place of accountability.
Yes. Yeah.
And that's why you're in the church. You're in the church to be grown up, to grow up, to mature, to be supplied with the instruction of how to move in God, how to move in the Spirit. And then there's an accountability before God to do it, to take hold of these things, to lay hold of these things. Now, Father, we thank you so much for this work of grace that you've done. Hallelujah. Okay, well, good. That's pretty good. Because many of you followed with me in the language of the Spirit, and then you followed me with the understanding also. And that's growth. And you need to see the growth. You need to be able to follow. Huh? We can just pray together. We can move together. It's just the same anointing. And then I praise God that you've been given, that you've been baptized in the Holy Ghost with the evidence of the language, but you must excel. Yeah. If you're not excelling, there's something wrong. There's something wrong. Usually that something wrong is where a fiery dart of the wicked one has been able to penetrate your life and burn within you some deception and some lie. And it's about time that you understand, wait a minute, I'm going to conform to the word of God. I'm going to lift up the shield of faith. I'm going to quit making it about me. I'm going to quit trying to do it with the arm of flesh. I'm going to, if there's a problem, I'm going to get on my knees and I'm going to pray the thing through. I'm going to shout the thing through. I'm going to pray the thing through. I'm going to look to God to do the thing rather than me. He's greater than all things that exist. If I look to him and submit to him and cast my care upon him, maybe you're my care. So I'm going to cast you upon him.
Amen.
What is he going to do? He's going to take care of it. Maybe I'm your care. Cast me upon him and watch what God will do. Amen.
Amen.
But just be real careful. Handle with care. Handle with care the flame of his presence that he's put in your life. Handle with care. Just be very, very careful. Because these are sacred things, they're holy things to God. I mean, you know, all of us are very important to the Lord and what we do to one another, we do to Christ Jesus. But there's special things about the anointing and the expressions of the anointing. And any expression of the anointing, I don't care what it is, on what level it is. I mean, you don't have to be a prophet to prophesy, but prophecy is so sacred. It's something that belongs to the flame of the Holy Ghost. We handle that with care. We approach it with sacredness because it belongs to him. Those vessels the Father has sanctified unto himself and handles in that way. I mean, come on, nothing can touch them. They're his. Don't touch it. You know, I've heard preachers to stand around and talk bad about something they don't understand, a ministry they don't understand. I'm like, people, you just don't even want to be doing this because all you're doing is saying, Lord, I don't want a ministry, I don't want an anointing, and I don't want you to use me. Oh, we preachers too, we can judge. You better be careful how you touch God's holy things. You're going to take yourself a whole high office. You better be hid away in the glory of his anointing and speaking only his word in your judgments. And what I hear is nothing but criticisms based upon your own opinions and your own preferences. Because, once again, that's where we get an indication that a fiery dart has now inflamed the emotions, inflamed the passions. One little word can stop it. In the name of Jesus, Satan, go.
Yeah.
One little word can stop it. The wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life. One little word will stop it. You should not yield your members to unrighteousness. Hallelujah. All right, people, we start doing these things and our words will take on a great authority in God. Our speech and our manner of living will take on a great authority in God. When we start speaking after the manner of the Holy Ghost, and living our life that way where it really counts with respect to our behavior, our attitudes, our response to God, then all of a sudden we discover that our words carry the authority of God into other people's life, breaking off yokes and strongholds. What a wonderful life to live. What a wonderful life to live. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Shuri Nana Eli Mananea. Hallelujah. The prophet Isaiah said, this is so clear that even someone who is brain dead can't err. No, he said it. Like if you looked in Isaiah chapter 35, that is somewhat of a free translation. But he actually says something more harsh. He says, basically, the village idiot cannot err therein. He says, the fool, the person that's walking around that doesn't know right from left. You say to him, do you know which one is your right hand? And he puts up his left. Are you listening to me? Because I'm breaking this thing down.
Somebody said, you're not supposed to be talking bad about people's handicaps.
Listen, I'm telling you what the Bible says. Isaiah 10 to 35, verse 8, look at it. He says, and a highway shall be there, and a way, and it shall be called the way of holiness. The unclean shall not pass over it, but it shall be for those, the wayfaring man. Though fools be there, they shall not err therein. I mean, the way is so clear. God himself is leading and instructing us. We should be able to get this no matter what level of intelligence we have. This doesn't take much figuring it out, in other words. Hallelujah. Because he's going to lead us. He's not only going to lead us, he's going to be with us and in us. He's going to be shouting. Shouts. Of redemption. Shouting shouts of grace. Hallelujah. You know, there are things that the enemy keeps bombarding him with, he'll hit us with, and there'll be maybe their relationship things, maybe their personal things, maybe they're, you know, things you've been desiring that you want and you just haven't had them yet or realized them in your life. But reality of it is, you've got to be able then in that place, once again, to be that much more confident and certain about the things that God has said and that what he has promised, and stay there in that place saying, Father has promised, Father, you've said, and I thank you that it is done. I may not have realized it yet, and it's not maybe not manifested in my life, but it's done because he says it's done. He says it's mine. He says it's yours. And Satan is coming out against us with everything that he's got to prevent what God has promised, to try to stop it. But the Lord says to us, just as Paul said to the Romans in Romans chapter 16, and I think it's like it's around, right around verse 20 or so, he said, and God, in the very near future, shortly, you just keep doing what you're doing, because very soon God is going to crush Satan under your foot. You will be discovered you have the mastery over him.
You can giggle a little bit.
Unfortunately, there are too many people in the conflict at some place. They don't lift the shield of faith, rejoicing in the fact that God has promised it, the truth that God is going to do it, the truth that it's supplied. It is yours. It can't be any other way. And they allow a fiery dart to come and begin to burn with a lie and deception, and then they lose hope. And now no longer are they there contending for the faith. And Satan's not going to be crushed under their foot. No. They were crushed under his foot. Having done all to stand, therefore. Yes. Didn't you hear the battle cry in Ephesians chapter 6?
Yes.
Hey, you could be strong. Look at his strength and his power and his might. Now, I believe that verse of Scripture implies and says that he has given to us his strength and his power and his might. But if you even just took it in this one other way that you could possibly understand the verse of Scripture, that is a whole lot of strength and ability just to look at God, because that's certainly true, that I can look at him and say, there is nobody more powerful than you. You on my side. You in me. You for me. You have surrounded me with your everlasting love, with your everlasting promise, with your everlasting covenant, with your loving kindness, and with your faithfulness. I know that you are going to establish it. There's no way Satan can ever overthrow you. And I'm standing right here behind you. I'm like the little shy kid, you know, behind the dad, bugging my head out, looking at me where it was a while, getting back behind him so I feel secure for a while, getting up bravery up, and up coming and stuff, taking another little peek. My dad. Standing there, and, oh, look, I'm in Tehran, fiery darts will burn, can burn in our emotion, can burn in our passions, in the area of the lust of the flesh. And we find ourselves completely taken out by it. But listen, folks, it doesn't have to be that way. One simple little word of testimony, one simple word of truth, one simple little word of, Father, come help me now, come strengthen me now. Just to understand, there is no excuse for it. You can't give place to the devil in your life. You can't have doctrines that allow for you to just find yourself doing whatever it is, you know, that the powers of darkness put on you to do. And before long, you find yourself not even be tempted in that area. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Mm. And the flow gets stronger, more powerful.
Amen. Thank you, mighty God.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So come, brother, bradeshikia totalo. What you feel in your spirit and in your heart many times is going to be very different than the thoughts that you're having to deal with in the realms of thinking. Because God has allowed Satan and things that men do, obviously, it's easy to see it that way, to influence the way that you think. And you've got to learn how to quickly shut that thing down. That's why you keep your heart with all diligence.
Amen. Amen.
That's why you learn how to make sure. Wait a minute. I'm not going to allow that. I'm going to not allow that to influence me. Amen. I'm not going to allow that to affect my decision.
Amen. Huh?
That's I. You know, if all these things start coming at me from relationship point of view, and people got these things to say, I do a swan dive into the love of God.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. A swan dive, and then I go on the swan dive. I just go really, really deep. There's no shallow diving here. Swan dive. Amen. This is a deep, you know, kind of flying through the air. Amen. Hallelujah. 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 It is so good to walk around and baptized in the Holy Ghost. So good to walk around in His joy. Ain't it? It's so wonderful to know that how easy it is to access it. You wake up in the morning, you're a little bit tired, and you get in my sleep because Pastor preached for a long time. And you had to rush out the door, and you got in the car, and you're down the going down the road, you recognize you had two colors of socks on. You're running late, and you recognize, wait a minute, your gas is running low. You got to stop at the fuel station. You're running even late. Later, now some old lady's in a bus in front of you going slow down the road. Or something like that. It's time to praise. It's time to praise. It's time to thank God that He is the one who's providing for you. Hallelujah. It's time to get some joy. Hallelujah. It's time to get some joy. It's time to get something beautiful going on. Huh? Because all your anxiety and frustration ain't going to change anything about how the speed she's going. It's time to change the colors of your socks. You don't have time to stop and buy some new ones. Besides, that store's not open yet. Trying to get you ready for tomorrow morning. If you don't believe that you're in a war, if you don't believe that there is this prince of the power of the air whose focus is on stopping you from expressing any dimension of the love of Christ Jesus and the anointing of His power that only is going to function by faith, then you've completely been already taken out and you're delusional. The war is afoot. The war is afoot. The war is afoot. And the sooner you wake up to the reality of it, the more you can hide away in His glory and His power and His might and understand how to deal with the stuff that's coming at you right, left, and center and not act like it's just something strange. These fiery trials, which are different than the fiery darts. We got this stuff coming at us right, left, and center. It's a good thing we can worship. It's a good thing we're living around in heaven. It's a good thing that we're seated in heavenly places, we the untouchables. Yeah. It's a good thing that we have a shield of faith that quenches every fiery dart of the wicked one, quenches every one of them. All you can hear in your life is, kept by the power of God as a consecration. You know, when John Wesley was there on the ship in the midst of a storm and everybody was fearing for their life And he was tired of being down below with all the throw up and the puke and all the rest of the stuff that was going down with all the sick people. And you can only imagine, because that's not a very big room. And everyone's afraid to go up on deck because they'll be swept away into the water. And he opens up the hatch to just get a breath of fresh air. And he sees these guys out there worshiping on the deck of the boat. Who are these guys? Who are these people? The Moravians, full of the Spirit of the Lord, having their life totally consecrated to the one who keeps them. Their life has come to an end. They're no longer in charge trying to preserve themselves. They live only for him. And nothing can touch them that he doesn't allow. Wow. Shield of faith. Hallelujah. All the worry, all the tension, all the fear threats, all the other unrest comes to an end. All of a sudden you begin to get to live in the realms of that wonderful thing called the Spirit of the Son, which says God Almighty's my dad. I've got nothing to be worried about or concerned about. I have everything that I have need of. It's good over here. It is well with my soul. Hallelujah.
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 Thank you, Jesus. There are so many champions of the faith that have gone through far more difficult situations and times than any of us have. And it seems that with far less, they've done far more. And with far greater opposition, they stood much more faithful. Dear people, we're going to be required of more. And it's just, we can't let the cares of this life, the deceitfulness of riches, and the pleasures of this world, which also come against us once again and come as fiery darts, to burn up all the vision, all the passion, all the glory, all the anointing, all the purpose, all the consecration, and all the obedience that otherwise would be in our life if we didn't have so many alternatives and so many choices. Tonight I pray in Jesus' name that you make yourself so available to God. And that availability isn't something that's sitting around on the couch waiting for another day. But that availability is a yieldedness to go with him and start moving with him right now to say, it's mine. You can't say that about prophecy too long and not have it.
Amen.
You can't say that about interpretation of tongues or anything else in the manifestation of the Spirit.
Amen.
Too long and not have it.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Listen, the reason I have these things in my life is I'm desperate for them, I'm hungry for them. Everywhere I see them, I'll just want to tape it and listen to it over and again. Just do it over again. Sit in front of it and look at it and watch it and contemplate it. Study every move. Study every move of the Holy Ghost. Study every expression of the Holy Spirit. And what he's doing.
Amen.
And with every second, it's like, I'm so hungry for this God. I got to have this. And it's not sitting around, well, I'm not sure that that's really God. And that seems a little strange to me there. And I don't know why they're doing that. And, wonder what's going on now. Because you're not having anything with God with such a critical heart and suspicious. There's no hunger there. There's no hunger there. A fiery dart of the wicked one entered in, and a lie dominates there. A deception dominates there, burning up every possible place of hunger and thirsting after God and ridiculing that which is beautiful and glorious. And you just can't have that. You can't have any expression of that. It burns all over this region. People start hearing the language of the Spirit and immediately There's criticism. I can't believe that. I don't understand that. And that doesn't make any sense to me. When the reality of it is, it's God's gift that he makes.
Yes.
He's devoted a whole chapter of the Bible to in the New Testament. Never did that about any other gift. He's put it in the highest level, in the supreme position of that which we desire. And yet, because a fiery dart entered in of deception and lie, all it can do is ridicule. That's just one example, because it's across the board in so many different displays of what God wants to do through our lives by his anointing. And Satan, as he's pictured in the book of Revelation, is like a dragon, a great serpent, who looks at the anointing as soon as it's born, represented like as a man-child, to devour it, to destroy it as soon as it's born. Just like Herod tried to destroy Jesus. As soon as it's born, destroy it, cut it off. Just like Pharaoh tried to destroy the firstborn of Egypt during the time, excuse me, that Moses was born. Didn't come at any other time. They were there for more than 200 years. It didn't come at any other time. Came at the time, God's appointed time, when Satan knew that someone who would yield to God and move and function and flow in the anointing, someone who had a call of God upon their life, and there was a possibility of a threat against his kingdom, let's destroy it. You have to recognize that, people. Otherwise, you're not going to know what's coming out against you and why. And you're going to then just treat everything like a happenstance, circumstance, just random state, you know, set of events, instead of standing up and saying, wait a minute, I know exactly what this is.
Yeah, right.
Yeah.
And then begin to deal with it effectively.
Yeah.
By the Spirit of the Lord, because there's no other way to deal. There's no other possibility. If you think for a minute that you can deal with the powers of darkness just because you're passionate about it, just because you're determined and persuaded, you're wrong. You have to understand how to let the Spirit of the living God flow through you. How to let the anointing of the Holy Ghost arise in you. Then all your enemies will be scattered. If you don't know how to cooperate with the Holy Ghost, if you don't know how to let God, the Holy Ghost, be manifested in praise, there is no way that, and I'm telling you, I'm talking to you as a person, as a mentor, as a leader, someone equipped by God to help you here. I'm better than a coach that got a bunch of people in the Olympics.
Amen.
Because I've been equipped by God. It's not human ability. Instead, if you don't understand, wait a minute, you've got to learn how to flow in the anointing and praise, because if you don't know how to do it there, you're never going to be able to flow in the anointing or rely upon the Holy Ghost to deal with anything else that's coming against you. It isn't about dealing with something coming against you. It's just about yielding yourself to the Spirit of the Lord to praise him. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Go ahead, giggle a little bit. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. 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 I tell you right now, you can't be happy in church. You can't be happy about God in anything. All you can do is be happy about some little fleshly thing, earthly thing, worldly thing, little bone the devil threw you. Are you listening to me? It's true. Somebody said to me, do you have to always describe these things in harsh tone? My answer to that is yes. Because I want to display for you, I want to paint a portrait as close as I possibly can to what it really looks like, so that you would despise being thrown a little bone by the devil. And that's all that makes you glad. Because you forfeited understanding how to flow in the joy of the Lord. And as the person who looks standing at you with a grumpy attitude and a frown on their face saying, oh, well, I believe in the joy of the Lord.
Right.
What do you have to say? Hallelujah. I'm just preparing to prophesy. I'm preparing to cast out devils, work miracles. Hallelujah. I'm just being prepared of the Lord to move in the greatest exploits and display of His power that has ever been seen in the church. I am. I'm ready for it. I believe it. I'm not wondering. Somebody said, oh, you said that a long time ago. So what? I continue to say it so long as it takes. I'm just declaring what God's going to do. I know He's going to do it. He's already said it in His Word, and it's been revealed to me. Huh? It was revealed to Simeon that he would not die until he seen the Lord's salvation. It's been revealed to me that I will not die until I'm moving in one of the great displays of the power of God in the earth. That I was born for it. That I was born to participate with God and making a way for the Lord to do it in the midst of His people. Yeah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Mm-hmm. No, I'm gonna tell you, I was just so blessed this morning. You know, those who came and prophesied, there's three different people who came and prophesied. The word of knowledge was given, those tongues, there was interpretation of tongues. There was simply the flow of an indication that the church of the Lord Jesus Christ exists here. Yes. People say, oh, it's the church of the Lord Jesus Christ, and they have no basis by which to do that because there is no manifestation of the Spirit that God described as being the declaration of His church. And people are willing to sit around and somehow play pretend and just say, well, we're just believing God. No, what? Hold up. If you're believing God, you're moving with Him and you're participating with what He's doing. That's believing. Believing has movement. It has action. It has a description. It has a display of that which God has said. It's not pretend. It's not hope so. It's not someday maybe so. It is so. It is so. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Proverbs chapter 30, verse 5. I know all of you have it memorized, but go ahead and turn there anyways. Every word of God is pure. Grab a hold of it. Every word of God is accurate. Every word of God is true. Every word of God is certain. Every word of God is going to happen. Not one jot, not one tittle, not one word which Christ Jesus said will in any way pass away until it's all fulfilled in you, if you will allow it. Until it's all fulfilled in that which He's described in the midst of His church and what God's purpose to do in the midst of His church until He comes. But how about fulfilled in you? How about fulfilled in me? I recognize not one word that He said is going to pass away until it's all fulfilled in me. It won't. It's, in other words, it's relevant. Every word He said is relevant. It's living and it's powerful. It's as an active agent right now to be fulfilled fully in me if I will participate. And I'm going to participate. I'm going to have every movement, every action, every word, every response, every behavior. You will not find me, I promise you. You will not find me 1 minute in doubt and unbelief. You will not find me there ever, anywhere, at any time. Amen. Feeling sorry for myself, wondering why this is happening, why that's. You shall find me in the place of those who have strength. You shall find me in the place of the mighty. You shall find me in the place of giving praise.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
And I pray that you would devote yourself to it. I had you singing the song for a long time. It's a song that came by way of tongues and interpretation of tongues a number of years ago in the ministry, and had you singing it for a long time. And it's time to grab a hold of it and be that, live that. Hallelujah. Be confident in what God has done. Hallelujah. Be certain that what He said He would do also shall perform it. Hallelujah. Not one word will fail. God's not a liar. Hallelujah. His faithfulness reaches under the heavens. Every word of God is pure. Hallelujah. He is a shield unto them that put their trust in Him. Look at the shield of faith working right now. Look at the shield of faith working right now. Having His word in my mouth, continually meditating on it, reciting it, speaking it out, declaring it, confessing it. The acknowledgement of every good thing that is in me. The profession of my faith, which I will hold fast to and not waver, for it has a great payday coming for those who will not weary in well-doing. Somebody said, oh, we just put Hebrews together with Galatians. Intentionally, because they're both saying the exact same thing. You connect them together and start doing it. Live this way. Live this way. If all hell's breaking loose on you, you should be standing there going, wow, I'm living in the realms of heaven. This is glorious. Because all you can see is Jesus. If they're leading you to the gallows to hang you, to the fire pit to burn you, to the lion's den, that the lions may consume your flesh, there should not be one trembling in your body, but a shout of glory in your soul. Your spirit should be ruling. Heaven, a glimpse of paradise, should be in full view. But it won't be so if you don't know how to yield to Him to praise. It won't be so if you don't know how to stand against, you know, some little opposition. The shield of faith is yours. It's a wonderful thing. And you must possess it. It's not like you got to go find it. Go on it. Like, what do they call them? Scavenger hunt. Pastor told us about the shield of faith tonight, but he didn't tell us where it was at. Boy, if I only had one. No, it's yours. It's the conscious recognition of what God has given you. That wonderful proclamation and declaration and confession of your faith. Your confidence in who He is to you and who you are to Him. Ah, that's the source. That's the foundation. That's the meat. That's the verbiage. That's the adjectives of praise. If you can't do it in praise, if it's not flowing through you fluently, I'm telling you, you need to understand how to lay hold on these things that the Holy Spirit supplies. And no longer be left outside, no longer be hindered, because all that could possibly be is a fiery dart burning up all the word that comes inside you, lest it should live. It's turning them into ashes and not allowing them to be integrated into your thinking and into your speech and into your manner of living. And let it be no longer. Let it be no longer. Huh? Then say, oh, this works great for Pastor Mark, but it hadn't worked out for me yet. Every word of God is pure. He's a shield to those who put their trust in Him. If you trust in God, you got yourself the shield of faith. Huh? If you're bold and strong because you recognize who He is and His strength and His power that is there made available to you, made more than available to you. He's actually brought these things into our life. And He's posed Himself as our guard and as our protector. And all we have to do is recognize Him. And no climbing, no Jacob's ladder over here. I'm climbing Jacob's ladder. I'm so glad we don't sing that song in here. It's a quartet song. It's supposed to be made for entertainment purposes. Tim, if you're watching me tonight, I thought you'd do a great job of it the other night, but still, I'm not climbing no Jacob's ladder. I'm not trying to get into a place that I've been translated into. And mine's not doctrinal based. It is a living confession of a reality that is expressed in my life. And tonight, this is what Father has for you. He wants you to be able to speak out and proclaim that which is a living reality being expressed in your life by the Holy Spirit. You're not hindered anymore. In the mighty name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Well, Ramondeya. Hey, Rusha Fratata. Hallelujah. Ikara mama nanana. Haramamandeya. Haramamandeya. Haramanda silikeo. Hale mambrana seya. Hallelujah. 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 Sickness departs out of your body in the name of Jesus. Thank you, living God. Thank you for this authority that you've given us. Is there any problems over here? Mombrondeya. In the name of Jesus, you foul spirit of sickness and disease, you go from the body now in Jesus' name. Viruses aren't even allowed in here. They have no right. You foul spirit of sickness and disease, you have no right to trespass against the property of God. In Jesus' name, we break off your yoke. We command you to go and to leave. We defy everything that you try to put at us or put on us. We resist you steadfast in the faith. You're about to be crushed under our foot. Amen. Whatever it is that opposes you, you just need to understand it's about to be crushed under your foot. Whatever's threatening you, you're about to prove that you're the master of. You have absolute authority over. Hallelujah. It has to obey you. Hallelujah. This is the inheritance of God's view. Our heritage in Him. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah. Giggle a little bit. Hallelujah. Praise God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Can't you just feel that praise bubbling up on the inside? It's joy, isn't it? It's just a joy unspeakable and full of glory, isn't it? Isn't it? And it's got to be enough to take you over into the morning. It's got to be enough. It's got to be enough. It's got to be enough to where it produces dreams and visions. It's got to be enough to produce the things that God said in His Word. It's got to be enough. It is enough, this flow of heaven in my soul. Hallelujah. Father, we thank You that every one of us tonight are being taught of You, Holy Spirit, how to allow the flow of heaven to dominate and rule our soul. The passions of the Holy Spirit to be all the passions that we know.
Yes, Lord.
That all other passions have no real value, have no meaning at all.
Amen.
Lord, that we come under Your control. Tonight, Father, I pray that all the young people and all the teenagers especially will come under authority.
Yes, Lord.
They will recognize the beauty of authority and that it is actually a satanic realm to defy authority. It is a satanic realm to rebel against authority. And Lord, that we look to You, the one who has absolute and total authority, and we submit to that authority. And we want to have every area of our life trained to submit to that authority so that You rule over us and nothing else can rule. Hallelujah. Father, if there's any young people in here tonight and they've not been in submission to the authority of their parents, Father, I pray right now in the name of Jesus that in your love and your mercy, you have caused them to recognize the evil of that thing and that they will repent the destruction of that thing and that they won't allow it anymore. That fiery dart that produces within them a lie and a deception that begins to burn in their mind and their thoughts and their passion that works so subtly, that seems to enter so easily. Which should never be, by the way. Because you and I should be submitted to the authority of the Word and the Spirit. And when we are, then we just naturally have a shield of faith. When our response is, Lord, I'm going to obey you. I'm going to do your will. I'm going to walk your way. I don't want anything else in my life but what you've described and what you've declared. And we've allowed his word to be in our heart and in our mouth. People, I'm going to tell you right now, those fiery darts cannot take place. They cannot burn within us. But somehow if we've opened the door to the wicked one and we've decided that we're going to have it our way or do it our way or walk in our own will, then once again, we're wide open to the fiery darts, and it's going to burn one way or the other in our lives, and it's going to run, it's going to work wreckage and ruin. Yeah. And that's all sin does, is work wreckage and ruin.
True.
All it is destructive. It hurts people right, left, and center. Yeah. And if you want to grow up to be a person that destroys every good thing that God gives you and that you have an opportunity to have in this life, that's sad. But if you're going to learn how not to destroy every good thing and make ruin of it and make hell where there should be heaven, you're going to learn how to obey God.
Yes. Amen.
And it's just that simple.
Yes. Yes. Amen.
Just that simple.
Yeah.
It's not any more complicated than that.
Thank you.
You want heaven? You obey God.
Amen.
You walk in his ways.
Amen.
And you have love and you have blessings.
Amen.
And you have relationships that last.
Amen.
And you have joy in your life.
Yes. Amen. Hallelujah.
And everybody who's in your life produces joy as well.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
And it's just a joyous relationship.
Yes.
Joy's flowing one way and back the other.
Yes. Hallelujah.
Joy's flowing out of me, and what's flowing out of me, people are drinking of.
Yes.
And when they drink, then floods of joy start flowing out of them, and I'm drinking off that.
Amen.
And then it produces more joy and just a flood of heaven, just right, left, and center. Heaven.
Heaven.
Heaven. Come on in. This is where the real fun's at. This is the place that overcomes. This is that power, the overcoming power that overcomes the world, even our faith, even this place where we walk in trusting in Christ Jesus, obeying him, agreeing with him, moving in that which God the Holy Spirit supplies. And over and again, Jesus says to his churches in Revelation chapter 2, Revelation chapter 3, he says this, to him that overcometh will I give. And now he's describing everything that you want, everything that I want, everything that I'm laying hold of. It really, the big deal, what really matters is when we cross over from this dimension of life into this is a temporal dimension right now. But we will cross over from this temporal dimension of life into an eternal. And I want you to be on that day. I want you to be so excited on your home, going. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
One man of God, and I'll just tell you who he was. His name was E.W. Kenyon. E.W. Kenyon wrote a lot of wonderful books. He had some things that I didn't necessarily agree with, but fine. For the most part, it was just all about Jesus and walking in this wonderful liberty that's in Christ Jesus and walking in holiness and purity. It was in the late 1800s. And one day, I believe he was in his 90s, something like 96. If I've got the story a little bit wrong, just have grace. It's close enough. Pretty sure he was 96. He said to the family, he said to all of his family, he says, I'm going home today. Just all joyful. He's a joyful man, joyful little man, full of the Holy Spirit. He said, I'm going home today. The Lord showed me I'm going home today. And they're like, oh, Dad, you're not going home. You're going to be around in Jesus' name. And everybody's rebuking it. He says, no, I'm going home today. And then, like, you're fine. There's nothing wrong with you. He's completely healthy. He said, no, I'm going home today. And so later on in the day, you know, he's just sitting in his comfy chair in the living room. And he's reading. He just went to sleep. That's a great way to go.
Yes.
Just all excited. I'm going to see Jesus today like I've never seen him. I'm going to step over to the realms of glory. So many people on their deathbed, oh, I haven't done enough. There's fear. There's anxiety. There's restlessness. Oh, pray with me. Oh, get some worship music going on in here. Oh, and there's pain and there's despair in the room. You need to prepare for a better day than that. You need to prepare today for a better home going than that. You can lay hold on the faith of it. If you read E.W. Kenyon's books, that's one thing. It's like him and A.B. Simpson and others. You're going to hear him talking faith all the time. Talking confidence. Talking boldness. Talking certainty. Talking what God's word said. Whether you see it or not, is certain. What you see and what you think you perceive is no bearing on the reality of what's really going on. Just because you can't see it. If your eyes were open, you would see a whole lot more. And if you'll just obey God and trust God and recognize that every one of his word is pure, it's a description of the reality of what's really going on, and that's all you really need. His Father telling you, this is what's happening. I can't see. It's like a blind man. Tell me, what do you see now? Oh, I see beautiful trees and clouds. The sky is a pastel blue. Of course, blind person doesn't know. And you're just describing to them. And they're going, oh, that's beautiful. Oh, that's wonderful. Oh, I can't imagine what it's like. But the word is good enough. You're not wondering, are they telling me a lie? Is it really cloudy and it's dark and lightning bolts really strike me? What Father is describing, you're certain of.
Amen.
In his word.
Thank you, Jesus.
And then as you praise him and you worship him for all the promises of divine health, the divine strength, the divine ability of your divine inheritance, of the power and the authority that's been given to you, of his love that he's lavished upon you, that he'll never forget you. Though a woman, a mother may forget her second child, the Father will never forget you, of his mercy and of his grace. And you're just so excited about it. And you just talk about it and you sing of it. You magnify the Lord. You declare his deeds among the people, his wondrous works among the nations. That's our job. I've just got to read that in closing. I got to get your mouth in the right place. I got to get your heart and your mind in the right place. It's 1 Corinthians chapter 16. Most of you know where it's at, right? Huh? You know where it's at, right? Everybody says yes. Could you turn there, 1 Corinthians chapter 16, and tell me what verse you land on? Are you there, baby? With your big Bible? Huh? Declare his deeds among the people, his wondrous works. Are you there? You're not even close, darling. 1 Chronicles. Did I say Corinthians?
Yeah.
Here. 1 Chronicles. Everybody's going, I don't know if I recognize scripture like that. In 1 Corinthians. 1 Corinthians chapter 16, some of you said yes, and my goodness, what are you talking about?
Verse 8.
I love all of 1 Chronicles 16. Uh-huh. Isn't it a praise chapter, eh?
Yes.
Hallelujah. What a psalm. It was what a psalm that was sung. This is how David taught the priest to sing. Think about these beautiful words. I'm closing this. Think about these beautiful words, this revelation of who God is, so they could declare the truth about who God is and what he's doing, that David taught the priest to sing. Imagine what God the Holy Ghost is teaching us right now, how he would teach you, how we would make your tongue as a ready writer. A pen of a ready writer. That would begin to express to you the display of God's beauty and his splendor and his greatness and his goodness and what he's doing right now in the midst of his people and what he's eager to do.
Amen.
In the
priest.
If David
yes,
could,
amen.
Come on.
Yes, amen.
And if you'll get excited about it, if you'll begin to believe it, begin to move with it with an expectation, it will happen.
Yes, amen.
It will happen.
Amen.
And even if you don't have a voice, like I said, you'll rap it. I always thought it was really funny when you listen to the ancient Greeks, and when they sing a song, it's just somebody playing an instrument in the background and all they're doing is saying it, right? And that's the song? It's like, come on. Right? Where's the music? Are you with me?
Yeah.
You can do that too. And we won't say, come on, where's the music? Oh, hallelujah. If you will just believe the Lord, you will be established. It will be yours. The impossible, unbelievable, unimaginable, miraculous thing will be yours. And I'm telling you, that was given in a context where it was threatened on the highest level. And where a person was going to have to prove that on the highest level at the greatest expense of the cost of their life. And the Lord allows us kind of warm up two hands for beginners. We were born in an age and a period of time where the government is not hostile to the church. It's unique to the history of the church. And so Christians in this culture where the government is not hostile to Christianity, to the church, have been able to prosper and enjoy luxuries and enjoy freedoms and enjoy a time of, as it were, relative peace with respect to living with men that the church has not known. And in it, we can't sit back in the luxury of the opportunity and the blessing, but we should press it all the more. When the enemy's in retreat, you don't relax. You press it. You put the press on. People only fight. Some people don't fight when the enemy is advancing. They curl up in a corner and they you know, fetal position and they whine. Don't do that. I'm sure no one in this place does that. And I promise you, if I saw you doing that, I would not sympathize with you. I'd come kick you. And I would say, get up. And somebody said, no, you're supposed to be a nicer person. No, I'm not. I'm the drill sergeant. This is the army of the Lord.
Amen.
And I'm a drill sergeant.
Amen.
Amen. And we're going to tell you to look to divine grace and look to divine power. Father will take you from that fetal position and make you stronger than the stoutest of heart. Make you bolder than the person who had absolutely no fear or trepidation. The Spirit of the Lord will come upon you and change you into a different person. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord. Call upon his name. Make known his deeds among the people. Sing unto him. Sing psalms unto him. And now the Lord says, sing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. Talk ye of all his wondrous works. This is what occupies our every day. And all you're doing is learning how to get a jump start. You're learning how to do it in praise and worship. That's it. And if you're not learning how to do it when praise and worship time comes along, then it's all for naught. It's for nothing. This praise and worship you're supposed to be doing is helping you learn how to hook up with this wonderful realm of the anointing.
Yeah.
So no matter what's coming out against you, no matter what you have to stand in the midst of, no matter whether it's good or whether it's bad, you find yourself raptured in this flow of the Holy Ghost. Amen. Glory ye in his holy name. Let the heart of them rejoice that seek the Lord. Seek the Lord and his strength. Seek his face continually. Remember his marvelous works that he hath done, those wonders in his judgments of his mouth. That's your assignment. That's your assignment. That's your homework. Do we need to review it? Everybody, would you stand with me? I pray in the name of Jesus, there's not one person in this place who's not touched by the healing power of the living God, that wherever you had a sickness or a disease or a hurt or a pain, that today, tonight, you recognize that this is an opportunity to experience God answering all your prayers. Can you imagine? Can you imagine that you could step into a moment in time, in a moment of walking with God, of moving in him, to where that he answers all of your prayers, and anything that you say, he'll do it. And that's what he's described. He said, I'll answer all your prayers. Whatever you ask, I'll do it. That means I'll answer all your prayers. And don't let any fiery dart of the wicked one burn in you some kind of lie or deception to make it seem like that he's going to answer some of your prayers, or you wonder if he's going to answer any of them because it seemed like nothing happened. No, Father, just trying to get your attention to recognize, wait a minute, there's some things that need to be straightened out in your life, some behavior, some manner, some reactions, some attitudes. It's people you need to forgive. His mercy endures forever, and he'll forgive you as many times as you need to. But I'm going to tell you right now, if you're not willing to forgive, you don't get to get forgiven. He say over and again, I'll forgive you. But then he says, I'm not going to start until you first forgive. Yes. It's like Jesus coming with a healing power, resurrection power, to raise Lazarus from the dead. But Mary wasn't on the same page. Martha came out to meet him. And you can read it in John chapter 11. And he stood right there in the same spot. He would not move from the spot that he encountered Martha. And he said, you go get Mary. Because basically he's saying, until everybody's on the same page and agrees, I'm not moving from here. I'm not going any further. And so many people are experiencing the same thing. At least Mary jumped up. Martha said, the Lord is calling for you right now. She could have said, I'm not coming. You tell him I'm not coming. I'm upset. Because my brother wouldn't have died if he was here. And I just don't think he cares. I used to think he cares. But now I don't think he cares anymore. Think about it. Come on. We all act the same way. I don't know what all Martha had to say to him. Say to her, rather. She might have said, listen, you get yourself up right now. Get your attitude straightened out. Who knows? We'll find out all the rest of the details later. What I do know is that she said, you get up. Master's calling you. She got up. And the first thing she had to let come out of her mouth was what was in her heart, her complaint. If you would have been here, my brother would have not have died. And there's so many people that don't know how to properly deal with their complaint. They're sitting at home and unwilling to meet Jesus at the place of the miracle because a complaint, a fiery dart, is burning in their life and in their spirit with lies and deception against the truth. And it's preventing their miracle. And in the name of Jesus Christ tonight, there's nobody in this place who's going to fall victim ever again to another fiery dart. Hallelujah. And praise God, everybody in this place, oh God, you're my God, everybody in this place knows how to put out the fiery darts that are burning on the inside of somebody. Because you know how to just walk them through the problem of their issues. You get around Jesus and what's on the inside, and your problem, your issue is going to come out. Jesus is going to let you know who he is and what he can do. Amazing, isn't he? He's so touched by the feeling of our infirmities. He so understands our fetal positions. Our place of retreat, our place of weakness. And he's there to encourage us and tell us to stand upright on our feet, to strengthen that which remains, to lift up our hands which hang down, strengthen our knees that are feeble, lest that which is lame turn us out of the way. He's there. And we understand how to put out the fiery darts, as I was saying. We know how to lead people in repentance. And tonight, that's what I'm doing. I'm leading you in repentance that there's something that's been going on in your life that is burned in your life with an accusation. It's a memory. It keeps reoccurring. It's something that has nothing to do with the love of God, the mercy of God, the goodness of God. It is some kind of a threat, some kind of an accusation, some kind of a slander, some kind of a criticism, some kind of a defeat, some kind of a discouragement. It's a fiery dart. And all you have to do is just repent. Say, Lord, forgive me for that attitude I want. I don't want that thing in my life. Forgive me for that decision that I made. Forgive me, Lord, for that way of thinking. Forgive me, Lord, for those words which I've spoken. Lord, forgive me for thinking like that. And as you do, as you just repent and you tell him, Lord, I don't want these things in my life. I only want that which pertains to your love and your joy and your goodness and your confidence and your boldness and your encouragement. I don't want to be thinking bad about people and wondering whether or not they're trying to sneak around and do something bad against me or whatever, some accusation. some slanderous thing. Thing of insecurity. Don't let it be in your life. From this day forward. Because all it's going to do is hinder the good things, the wonderful things of heaven. You don't want that. And I don't want that. Be the church. The church. Tonight, praise God, we get to stand here in this place of intercession for humanity. With Christ Jesus, in Christ Jesus, who's interceding. There's a lot of churches that don't have a meeting on Sunday night. There's so many people that didn't come to the meeting because they've let fiery darts keep them out of the meeting. And I pray that you'll take up their part and you'll take up their cause and begin through this week to pray for them, the people that aren't around. That it has been taken out by silly things. I know that people recently have left the church because they don't believe that everybody should speak in tongues all at the same time. You know what? If they're going to be so convinced that they're what they know about the Bible is superior to everybody else and they're going to make decisions based upon that, there's nothing that anybody can do to stop them. There's people that have left because they feel like that no one loves them. It's fiery darts. I mean, that's as far from the truth as can possibly be. That's just nothing but deception and lie. That's a fiery dart. And all we can do for them is begin to cry out to God and pray and intercede. I mean, if everybody who came to the meeting would stay, the house would be full. So I want you to pray and believe God that you'd be able to yield in a greater way to the flow of His love so that when folks come in here, you just love them more. Just love on them more. Don't be all awkward. Like a person said to me, he said, well, you know, he says, I know that there are some people come up and they're going through the same thing that I'm going through. They're not really comfortable hugging people and telling them that they love them. He said, and every once in a while somebody comes up and I recognize they've really got it. You can feel it. They're not in my same situation. I said, well, that's fine. Maybe there's a lot of people in that situation. The only way to break that thing is start hugging more people. You can say, I'm not going to hug anybody until I love them because I don't really feel it. No, you just got to keep doing until you got it. Yeah. Deal with yourself until you got it. Because there will come a time in your life, in this house, if you'll cooperate with what God's doing, that you'll be so captured by His presence, raptured by praise, that love will flow through you and you won't even recognize yourself. You'll grab people and you'll hug them. And you'll tell them you'll love them and they'll feel it because it's real. It's real. Hallelujah. There won't be any awkwardness to it. There won't be any. Oh, Jesus. You know, I often think of Summer, who, because she described it so perfectly. She said, when I went to the altar and responded to the altar call, she said, I felt something, but nothing happened like happened after the altar call. When people started coming up to me, started hugging me, and telling me that they loved me. And I could feel the genuineness of it. She said, with every hug, just a change came. The supernatural change came. A reality was demonstrated. It wasn't a religious process, a reality of something that someone else possesses. There was a proof, you understand. There's an evidence that only can be supplied and witnessed through you as you yield to the Holy Spirit. And you've got to understand that the highest level of that is this love and this affection of God. that it's not going to happen any other way than the flow of the Holy Spirit. And if you've got him that way, you've got him in every way, in miracles and signs and wonders and praise and thanksgiving and tongues and interpretation. Every way. It's just all one big arena of divine glory. And there's no question about it. The Lord trains us in his love. Amen. He trains us in his joy. Hallelujah. 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 Tonight, some of you, I know that some of you weren't in the morning service, and I want you to be able to come and give your and worship the Lord with your tithes. You don't want to miss out on that. The Lord puts that on the highest level in the Old Testament, on the highest level. And I know it goes over in the New Testament. There's nothing the Father says ever concerning prove me. Or he says things like you've robbed me or you've disrespected me. Like he says around the offering. There's nothing he places the highest level of watch and see if I won't bless you. Watch and see if you won't have the windows of heaven open on you. And then, of course, he repeats that in the New Testament when he says, that we can, when we sow, whether it's sparingly or generously, that he will cause all grace to abound unto us so that we'll have all sufficiency in all things. That's a whole lot of awe. So you make sure that you honor the Lord with your tithe. I don't care if you can't pay your mortgage, you give the Lord your time. If you can't eat, you give the Lord your time. If you've got to hitchhike to church, you don't take that. You spend it on yourself. You don't. It belongs to him. It's already his. Consecrated to him. I want to make sure that you do that. I want you to make sure that you understand tonight we're going to receive an offering. It's different from your tithe. And it's going to go to doing exactly what the Lord told us to do with it. To reach the lost with it. To take care of those who are afflicted. In this particular instance, it is the untouchables in India. And the orphans, both in India and Nepal. All of the finances, basically what we're going to do is we're going to split them right down the middle. Half of it is going to go to Naveen's ministry at the Holy Ghost Church there in, what's the name of the town? Chiawada? Vijayawada. Vijayawada, India. Vijayawada, India. And the other half of it is going to go to Sudeep for Compassion Asia, specifically focused on Nepal and the orphanages in Nepal. And so do we have any envelopes that we can pass out? Are there envelopes in the house? Could you quickly bring them? Not delay. Quickly bring them. We certainly don't need you turning any knobs up there on the soundboard. Everybody get an envelope, because what I want you to do is I want you to put in the envelope the offering that's going to go to Vijayawada, India, and to Nepal. And once again, whatever comes in, we're going to split it right down the middle. Half of it's going to go to Sudeep, half of it's going to go to Naveen. We're going to start doing this every month, the end of the month, third week of the month. Hallelujah. And as you're giving, I want you to believe God. I want you to believe the Lord that there's going to be a multiplication in that giving so that you're going to be able to give more. Yes. And what I'm doing is I'm sowing in, we're sowing in, and I'm sowing in to the vision that I have for orphans. Yes. And for the afflicted. And so here's where, this is a very specific way. I mean, there's other ways we're doing it, but this is a very specific way. We're going to see it grow. Hallelujah. We could be very self-centered tonight and we could say, we need so much more finances right now. for the church in Oregon. We're going up with the thing. My goodness, the amount of work and labor that we've got to get pulled together. Finding workers there is very difficult. Getting the things done in a timely fashion, challenging the finances, all the stuff. And we can be very self-centered with what we're going to do. Well, I've got this thing to do. But that's not the way it works. I want you to show you by model of how these things work. You don't go with whatever is pressing on you. You go with what God's directed you to do. Because a lot of times what the Lord will do is He'll see the need that we have and He'll say, okay, I want to bless you in that need, but here's how I'm going to bless you in that need. You're going to sew over here to this thing over here.
Amen.
And you think, wait a minute, wait. How is that going to help this need here? No, that's how He gets supernatural supply to you.
Yeah. Yes.
You sew over here into this need, and then all of a sudden God opens up a as it were, a window of heaven, a floodgate. Hallelujah. That's for irrigation. Floodgates for irrigation. Oh, my. Ditch is dry till the floodgates open. My. And then everything starts multiplying. You know, it's amazing. When we begin to honor God for who He is, we get stuck within the limitation of what we can do with our own human effort. But if we'll stop, because that's once again where a fiery dart can come in and burn with a lie and deception and shut down faith. And what the only way to quench that violence, that wicked, that literally a fiery dart from the wicked one, from Satan, is to begin to recognize who God is, that He's all powerful, that He's the Almighty, that He is the absolute sovereign who has promised to supply everything that we have need of, who's promised to multiply the giving, whose word is absolutely certain, who you can have great confidence in because He's the one who controls it all. He controls everything.
Yes.
Not so things, everything.
Yes.
And then all of a sudden when I'm thinking that way and I'm speaking that way, any fiery dart that the wicked one try to come and hit me with to keep me from giving and moving in faith, it's quenched. All you hear is, shh.
Amen.
And I'm going to go ahead and I'm freed now to move in faith and confidence that what I'm getting ready to do, I'm going to give. Father is going to take care of all the other areas of my need. Furthermore, not only is He going to take all care of all the other areas of my need, supplying it according to His riches and glory, but He's going to multiply that which I've sown so that now He causes all sufficiency. He's the all-sufficient one who causes all sufficiency. And I can be strong in this because of His strength and the power of His might and the fact of who He is and what He is able to do. That's why it's so important for your praise and your prayer to be in constant proclamation of who God is, of what He's promised, what He's able to do, what He's going to do, what He's done and what He's doing. Because it builds within your life boldness and faith, certainty.
Hallelujah.
The word of faith.
Amen.
Powerful, eh?
Yes.
And so, once again, in giving tonight to the orphans and to the untouchables, and I'm believing for many souls.
Yes.
I'm believing for thousands of untouchables just this year. Just this year.
Amen.
Thousands of untouchables this year. Coming into the kingdom. Hundreds of orphans being so well resourced in the ministry of Sudeep and Annalise that they grow up in that atmosphere that's being provided for them. And once again, any of you want to go labor in orphanages, you know, obviously we've got plenty of places to place anyone. You don't have anything else to do. Give me a break. We got a bunch of things we're going to help you with. But just seeing those orphans just grow and develop into mighty men and women of God. Because, you know, there's thousands of orphans right in Nepal alone. There's some of the best and most profitable ministry is to the young children. Just pouring your life into them. Watch what happens. And I'm not. There's absolutely no need to build orphanages. There's way too many orphanages already built already up and running that are not properly resourced, that you walk in there and there are so many places that I know of right now. If you walk in with the finances to resource them, whatever you say for them to do, they'll do it. They'll just simply say, send us the people. If you want to send us people to lay hands on all the kids to receive the baptism of the Holy Ghost and want to pray for them every day for the next rest of their life, fine, do it. It's true. So there's no need to build new buildings and spend, you know, hundreds of thousands of dollars on each building. They're built. There's so many built. There's some place, some that need to be relocated. And Father's given us a vision for the waste to do it differently. I mean, because look, we could be here for another 1,000 years. I don't know if you don't think that way, but I mean, just imagine you tell the early church, first century church, just walk in behind Paul and say, hey guys, you know, the Lord's not going to come for another 2,000 years. They would have stoned you. You would have been cast out as a complete total heretic. And people say, oh, it's so bad. It's going to get a lot worse. And no, I want Jesus to come now. And I'm saying, Lord Jesus, come quickly. Even so, come quickly. I am. But I'm just saying, there is a possibility that we could still be here. The church could still be here. The Lord continued to allow this thing to go on for the harvest that he wants to bring in. And for the ultimate conclusion of where things have got to go. Could you imagine what this earth is going to look like in 1,000 years? Just think about this. In 1,000 years, if the Lord were to wait another 1,000 years, tarry another 1,000 years, what this earth is going to look like. I have no doubt about interplanetary travel. I have no doubt about the highway being in the sky. I mean, just full on Jetson kind of crazy things. I have no doubt about the oppression and the tyranny, the things that are going to come. I have no doubt about the need of provision and the ways to be have wise wisdom and to see the coming and say, if you do these things or if you do these sets of things, if you prepare these kinds of places and set your heart on these kinds of activities, you can have an isolation and a buffer from it. And I'm going after those things in God. I'm not living for the temporary. Hello. Consider the ant sluggard. You know what I'm saying? I want vision from God. I've labored, press in for vision. And so when we're doing this, it's just about vision. Tonight when you're giving, it's about vision. You're not just giving to be, you know, responsive and obedient and to direction and cooperative. That's the seed is about vision. Lord, I want to be able to see too. And an ability to see, it comes along with the seed. There's so much there. Lord, I'm vested in this. I want to be a part of this. And the Lord knows what's wrapped around money in our lives. No money, no food, can't eat, kind of thing. He knows what's wrapped around it. And he wants us to recognize, wait a minute, I'm going to provide for you according to my riches and glory. Lord, that we don't have those equations going on in our lives. There's a faith realm. But he still sees, listen, I'm sowing into this because I want to be a part of it, because I want to see. I'm believing God to raise up seers. I'm going to tell you one of the things that I really am very unhappy about, and I want the Lord to change it, but most churches are in the condition. We don't have 3 people in the office of a prophet here. 2 or 3 people in the office of a prophet. It's supposed to be. It's the order of the church. There should be at least 2 or 3 who function in the office of the prophet. So what I did was I purposed then to move in God and move in faith to raise them up. Because the reality of it is there's a great depletion of these things and these giftings and these offices because of various decisions that were made in denominationalism and in the church. And it is an office that God gives. But we can raise it up by keeping the press on. We want Holy Ghost and Holy Ghost alone. We're going to have it God's way. God, Amen. We only want it your way. Amen. And being desperate about it.
Yes.
And being fervent about it. And being persistent about it.
Yes.
And you know, people come and they look at that and they go, I don't understand that. Why don't you accommodate? I'm not going to accommodate. I'm not going to fit into what is normal and what everybody can relate to. If it was what God is saying, what he's proclaimed in his word, that would be wonderful. I'm going to stick with what he proclaimed in his word, what he's purposed for us to have. We're not going to let up. And I appreciate so much the value that you're able to see what's going on here. And this isn't coming out of left field. And you go, can't even understand, why is the pastor talking like this? But your eyes are open. And you go, well, I get it. You know what? There really has to be a culture change in the church.
Amen.
That the manner in which God set up the church and the things that he described in his word just really aren't being fulfilled. And it's not Father's will. It's about men's will being connected with his will and us pressing into heaven. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord Jesus.
Thank you, Lord Jesus.
Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Father, that everything that belongs to your house and everything that belongs to your church is opportunity for you to pray too. You don't have to sit and listen to me pray. That everything that belongs to your house and everything that belongs to your church will take place in this place. In the mighty name of Jesus, Father, we want those things that you described in your word to be here. And we submit our will to it. We submit our hearts to it. We submit our purpose to it. And we're going to press into habit. And we're not going to let up in Jesus' name until everything that you said is realized by us. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Now, the more you'll do that with me, the more you'll pray by the prayer of faith and the prayer of the Spirit very specifically. It won't be a struggle. It'd be a flow. Just do it with me. Huh? Just like you hook up with the... You can hook up in the same way where you don't have to hear what I'm praying. You don't have to hear what I'm saying in the language of the Spirit to pray in the language of the Spirit, right? You're not trying to imitate me, are you? There is a flow of the Holy Ghost. Same thing will happen as you give yourself to it. You'll be praying almost the exact words or very similar words that I'm praying. You won't even hear what I'm saying. And it would be very definite. It would be a Holy Ghost-directed prayer, which is the prayer of faith. And I'm telling you right now, when we begin to pray together like this, there's nothing that we ask that Father won't do. There is a place that we'll walk with God, and whatever we ask God together in this place, Father will make it happen. Whether it's believing God for the order of his church, the things that he's purposed to be in the church being here, or whether it's increase or whatever it may be, seeing more people coming into the kingdom, being more effective and more useful in the kingdom, the gifts of the Spirit being more expressed in people's lives, whatever we pray, and we begin to take it with great earnestness in the Holy Ghost. Not earnestness in our own human effort, but in the Holy Ghost. Amen?
Amen.
And then so in the envelopes what you're giving, right? And then anything that comes into the offering basket denoted either tithe or just it's check or money that's loose, not in an envelope, then that's going right into the things that we need to do for the church. And hallelujah. And I pray that you're praying with me for all of the things that are going on in the church and the activities of the church and the effectiveness of the church.
Yes.
And that you recognize that your role in the kingdom of God is to wear the responsibility of this church and how it grows and how it's effective and how it then ultimately expresses what God's described in his word. Because I can't do it all. I can't put on the hat of the pastor and then put on the hat of the congregation. Put on the hat of the prophet, then run up and be an apostle for a while, then be a teacher for a while, then be an evangelist for a while, and then be a congregant for a while. I mean, you know what? It takes all of us. And you carry that responsibility. So do so. Do so. God sees whether or not that is in your heart. And that's your purpose of living. And you're laboring in the kingdom as though it was your own, though you're responsible for everything. You're responsible for the sermons, songs, you know, flow of the Holy Ghost, bills, everything, whatever. You just take the whole thing. And as you labor effectively in God, you'll see increase in your life spiritually, and you'll see promotion in your life as God's able to use you more elsewhere. In Jesus' mighty name, that's what you're going to do. Everybody stand with me. Come worship the Lord with your giving. If there's anybody in the place you need prayer for anything, we're here to pray with you and for you. I'm certain Papa will touch you. If you got sickness in your body, he'll heal you. Torment in your spirit, your mind, your thinking, God will set you free. Listen tonight, if you're watching me by web, if you're watching me online right now, I want you to know the effectiveness of the power that is found in the name of Jesus Christ. Whatever you're going through, whatever you're dealing with, the name of Jesus Christ is a delivering name, the saving name. It is the expression of God's love for you. All you have to do is call upon that name and the Lord will come with His delivering power, His saving power, and He will touch you right where you at right now. He's promised it. If you've constantly been overrun by sin, by temptation, it's just like anything comes along and it seems like you just taken out by it. If there's a slight little bit of temptation, you're bowing to it. And you've never known the ability to be an overcomer. Today, in the name of Jesus Christ, you take a hold of the reality and the goodness of God that is right there for you, that gives to you faith, and the overcoming power that is in it will be yours in Jesus' mighty name. Sin won't be able to throw you around. You'll have a shield of faith. You'll put your trust in God, and everything Satan tries to come at you with, everything the wicked one throws at you, will fall as lifeless, powerless weapons. No effect on you in the name of Jesus. If there's anybody in this place or that's watching me right now by the web, you have never called upon the name of the Lord Jesus Christ in such a way to where that you became a new creation and you know that you are a new creature. You never understood what it means to be changed, what it means to be born again, what it means to have a new heart and a new spirit, what it means to be filled with the Holy Spirit. Baptized in His glory as well. Right now is your opportunity. Right now, today is the day of salvation. Christ Jesus is calling you. God the Holy Ghost is calling you. Father is calling you. He's not willing that any perish, but every single person come to the knowledge of salvation. Father wants to bless every single person alive with His life and His goodness. He wants to destroy the power of death and sin and despair off everyone. All you've got to do is be willing to put your trust in His only begotten Son, Jesus. Call upon His name. Heaven's mobilized to help you the moment that you do. Hallelujah. So do not delay in the name of Jesus. Do not delay. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.